The Villanova Wildcats' 1991 season has been nearly perfect, with an offense led by the Mighty Might junior quarterback Tom Colombo, the power running of senior tailback Pat Kennedy, and a smothering conference-leading defense. The Cats opened the season with five straight decisive victories, outscoring their opponents by a walloping 214-29. But the perfect season was not to be. The Wildcats ran into powerful Yankee Conference rival Delaware in a midseason showdown. The Cats fell behind early, and despite a courageous comeback, came up short for their first loss. Head coach Andy Talley's men showed their championship character, following up that disappointing day in Delaware with two big wins against William & Mary and Rhode Island. Like Villanova, New Hampshire has had a nearly flawless season. Head coach Bill Bowe's team is led on offense by versatile quarterback Matt Griffin and the spectacular running of junior Barry Bourassa, who had this 97-yard run last week to help the UNH Wildcats defeat Boston University. The New Hampshire Wildcats find themselves on top of the Yankee Conference. A win for them all but assures them a trip to the Division I AA playoffs. With a win today, the Villanova Wildcats gain a share of the Yankee Conference lead and a shot at the postseason as well. Coming up, the War of the Wildcats, the most important Yankee Conference game of the year. Prism Sports presents Villanova University football. Today, live from Villanova, the Wildcats take on the University of New Hampshire. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. Along with Drew Gordon, I'm Mark Zumoff. First place at stake today in the Yankee Conference. New Hampshire unbeaten. Villanova, Delaware tied for second, one loss apiece. Pat Kennedy, the all-purpose leader for Villanova, out for the rest of the regular season. Tom Colombo, the quarterback, with some pressure on him today.
He will. He'll have to play a good game today, especially with his head. He's going to have to keep people in the huddle motivated, make sure that guys don't get out of control because of lack of experience in Vernon Smith and Kevin Mosley. They have some big shoes to fill.
Colombo has spread it around this year, but he has some wide receivers who are injured, hobbled, hurting, what have you. Scott Donald, the tight end, he'll have to step in and take some of the slack away.
That's right. It's not unusual for Colombo to use eight different receivers during a game, but his big guy's got to be Scott Donald. He's the one that can catch the ball over the middle, control the offense, control the, you know, the first down situations as you drive the field.
New Hampshire with a very explosive offense. They have their own version of Pat Kennedy, if you will, in Barry Bourassa, a much different type of runner, but he gets the job done.
He does. He's good. He's fast. He's dangerous. He averages 39 yards on a kickoff return. You have to keep him inside. If he gets outside on you, he can hurt you with his speed.
New Hampshire's defense is very solid. They are a gambling defense, a lot of man-to-man on the secondary, and they have some pro scouts here watching today, a number of players.
Right. They have Sav, the big defensive end, who's going to the East-West Shrine Game, the only player out of Division I AA doing that, and Oliva, a real physical defensive tackle who can wreak a lot of havoc on your offensive line for you. So those two guys, they have to really control.
We have Harry Donahue with us here this afternoon. Harry will be combing the sidelines, and he will bring some perspective now on this Villanova New Hampshire series.
Thank you, Mark. This is the fourth meeting between the two Wildcats, the Wildcats from New Hampshire and the Wildcats from Villanova. Villanova's won one of the previous three, 10-7 a year ago. That was at New Hampshire. Now, this is a festive occasion. In addition to being perhaps one of the most meaningful football games in the Andy Talley era at Villanova, it's also homecoming. So a lot of the old football players are here. We'll have a chance to talk with some of them during today's game. And we'll also talk to Pat Kennedy, who was sidelined today and a big missing factor for the Wildcats. So a lot to come homecoming day here at Villanova Stadium. Mark?
And Harry, one other note, Andy Talley has never lost a homecoming game since helping to bring Villanova football back in 1985. Stay with us, won't you? The kickoff coming up, Villanova and the University of New Hampshire for first place in the Yankee Conference right after this. Villanova Wildcat football on Prism is brought to you by McGowan Lincoln Mercury Isuzu. Go west to McGowan. By Budweiser, Beechwood Age for that cool, clean, crisp taste. For all you do, this Bud's for you. And by your Quality Plus Ford dealers.
Have you seen what's new for 92?
Have you
seen the big introductory savings on the all-new 92 Ford full-size truck? it's been reshaped up here and around here with all new comfort in here. Right now, save $2,100 on F-150 options and cash back, or choose low 7.9 financing.
Have you driven a Ford lately?
Big savings on F-150 at your Quality Plus Ford dealer now.
So I'm doing my sound check.
Hello, hello, hello.
And I hear this woman's voice.
Crunch that last chord. I'll show you.
She grabbed the guitar.
And then she started rocking. No, I mean rocking.
You're pretty good.
Not.
Someone that hot deserves something this cold. Suddenly, I remember this was a bud spot.
I like your style.
Buying a new car can be a hazardous road to travel, with lots of confusing signals. So where do you go for the best deal? Which way do you turn for friendly service? There's only one direction. Go west to McGowan. Great prices and friendly service. McGowan, Lincoln, Mercury, Isuzu in Westchester.
Yeah!
Go west to McGowan.
With Drew Gordon, I'm Mark Zumoff. Back at Villanova, we expect temperatures today in the low to mid 40s. And those winds will be swirling, and if it comes down to the kickers, which this game very well might, it could be a horrific time for them. There you see the current conditions right now at Villanova as we are getting set for the toss of the coin and to see who kicks off and who receives. Of course, both teams have to deal with the weather, Drew Gordon, but Villanova has to deal with their emotions. They got a bit out of hand when they played Delaware earlier this year. They're only lost by 10 points.
That's right. Sometimes if you come out from a game in a game a little bit too tight, you have to let, you know, there's an outlet for that sometimes, and sometimes it comes out aggressively, and Villanova got called for a personal foul call early in the Delaware game that didn't help them at all. So, again, you learn from those types of things. I wouldn't expect to see that at all today.
So the Wildcats are going to receive, and Jeff Johnson is among those back deep along with Pat Smith, as Brian Cotter is going to kick off for New Hampshire.
Now, interestingly here, Mark, Villanova has the wind, and it's very strong from right to left. It's got to be up there around 20 miles an hour, and more important than Villanova with the wind is that New Hampshire has to kick into it. So I would expect maybe a short kickoff in Villanova, hopefully, to get that real good field position to start the game off.
Well, it's bad enough that we're out here with coats and hats and what have you, and Harry Donahue has to stay on the sidelines the entire game, but this fellow, a la Tony Franklin and I guess some others in history, is out there with a bare foot.
And not only that, but he's left-footed. So you have a bare foot, left-footed kicker out there who's probably going to hook the ball to the, you know, from left to right, as a lot of those kickers do.
Keep in mind the Villanova offense as the Wildcats get the football here. They have not scored fewer than 28 points in any game this year, yet in the last 2 years against New Hampshire, they have not scored more than 12 points. And we are almost set for homecoming here at Villanova. There's the kick and we're underway. It is short. Johnson lets it bounce at the 30. Breaks a tackle. He's in the 45. He's at midfield. He's got two to beat, including the kicker, who finally drags him down at the 35-yard line. What a way to begin the most important game of the Yankee Conference season as Johnson brings it into New Hampshire territory, first and 10.
Okay, again, that's what the wind will do for you. Now, whether Villanova chose to defend, which is, I would think, what Coach Talley did, we're going to see Johnson. He's going to take it on a bounce, which is a little bit dangerous. But he gets good blocking, finds the wedge in the middle of the field, and now it's missed tackles. There's two right there, and he'll cut to the left here and just outrun some people and get across midfield.
Johnson leaning Vernon Smith behind Colombo. George Brown and Pat Friend, the wide receivers. Colombo into the flat. It is complete to Smith, who falls, and he gets back just to the original line of scrimmage, actually about a yard or two short, as Smith tried to cut back against a very hard artificial turf and could not.
That's right. Again, when it's cold like that and it's hard, you have to do a little bit different when you get out there wide. When you're running the ball and you want to do your cutbacks, and that is just lift your knees a little bit higher and make sure you have the traction before you try to make the cut.
Good news that Bill Lacey is in there at right tackle, and Harold Hart, who had a staph infection, is in there now at one of the wide receiver spots, also out there with Strawn Lumpkin. They lost 2 yards at second and 12. Colombo again to the air. This time it's complete to Hart, who has run out of bounds at about the 25-yard line. He's about a yard or two short. It'll bring up a third down.
Okay, it's good to see Howard Hart in there. Tommy Clement indicated before that they were going to play him if necessary. Well, they were going to play him necessary or not necessary when you see him in the second and third play of the game. Likes to run that square out, and again, Villanova feels that because New Hampshire plays a lot of man-to-man defense, they'll be able to take advantage of those types of square outs, especially when they have one-on-one with the wide receivers.
A lot of man-to-man and a five-man line that likes to rush, a defense in general that likes to gamble. Opening moments from Villanova. Third and two for the Wildcats. They're at the 26 of New Hampshire. Third straight pass for Colombo. It is complete, and a first down for Villanova just inside the New Hampshire 20. The reception is made by Pat Friend. The tackle comes from Nathan Bryan. It'll be first and 10 for the Wildcats.
Okay, Villanova is going to run with man in motion. Colombo's just going to sprint out to his right here, and this is just an out pattern to Pat Friend as he breaks away from the receivers. He went out with three receivers. He just breaks to the outside. The defense a little bit slow in reacting. Easy pass play, good percentage play on third down.
Friend with his 18th reception of the year, first and 10 now on the 19 for Villanova. Again, it is Smith from the eye this time, and he fights his way for some tough yards to around the 15, maybe inside the 15-yard line. A gain of about five before Chris McGrath was able to trip him up. McGrath, the all-time leading tackler for New Hampshire.
We were talking to the Villanova coaches before the game, Mark, and they indicated, you know, their concern for New Hampshire that Barrasso can do this and the defense that. Can you imagine New Hampshire, you know, with Villanova, with all the scoring they do, what's going through their defensive people's minds?
Smith again in the eye formation. He is being led this time by Pat Smith, the fullback in there for Johnson. On the misdirection, Smith is able to get inside the 10 to about the 8-yard line. It could be enough for another first down. Ron Basden, Nathan Bryan in there to run him out of bounds. But not before Vernon Smith was able to turn the corner and indeed get himself and Villanova another first down.
This is good speed by Smith that time and great blocking up front. Pat Friend does a super job there. Pat Smith, I'm sorry, on the corner. And now Smith just outruns people. He gets down to the 6-yard line. You know, a first down, first and goal for the Wildcats.
On the 6-yard line of New Hampshire. So the big return by Johnson, and Villanova carries fourth now with two consecutive first downs. The pitch to Smith, who cuts back and runs into a wall of New Hampshire defenders, may have eked out a yard right there as they closed it quickly. Joe Fleming, who was in there, made the stop for New Hampshire.
Looked like Vernon that time cut back to the inside a little bit too soon. He gave away the outside, and that's where the play is intended. When you get that toss back there, you really like to play off of the either a double team block on the tackle or a kick out of the end, and Vernon cut it back a little bit too soon there. Defense able to make the play.
Smith did a wonderful job coming in last week against Rhode Island for the injured Pat Kennedy. Colombo again to the air. The timing pattern complete to Friend. Touchdown, Villanova.
Much Colombo, he's just going to sprint out. He does this well. For as short as he is, he has great feel and touch for this. Boy, the defender never even turned around, and Pat Friend did a good job of not putting his hands up for the ball until it was right there. Never gave away to the defender that the ball, in fact, was even on its way.
Bill Hoffman to come in to tack on the PAT out of the hold of Tom Colombo. So the Wildcats take advantage of the excellent field position after the return of Jeff Johnson to around the 35 or 36-yard line of New Hampshire. And Colombo to the air, and then the running of Vernon Smith, and finally the timing pattern to Pat Friend for the six, and now Hoffman in for the point after. Penalty flags go. The kick looked ugly. I don't see any signal from the officials, so we'll have to wait and see what the flags are all about.
Hopefully that would indicate that the penalty for the Wildcats, Villanova Wildcats, is on the New Hampshire Wildcats so that they're going to get a chance to kick it over again. And there was no need to indicate whether it was good or not good on the attempt.
Referee Joel Goldman now conferring with his compatriot officials. Colombo on that drive was 4 for 4 for 20 yards in the passing department, and Smith primarily took care of the rushing yardage. Here's Joel Goldman.
Inadvertent flag. I guess they're going to say the flags went down before the play should have been kicked, or before the ball was snapped, so therefore there's no flag and they're just going to do it over again. I think the Wildcats might be getting a break here.
Yeah, because I don't believe the kick by Hoffman was good. I did not see an official signal. Nonetheless, Hoffman a chance to do it again. And that one is punched through. It is good. 12 minutes, 17 seconds to go in the first quarter. And in this very important Yankee Conference game, the Wildcats jump on top. This is the Villanova Football Network.
You might know who we are. We know who you are. Understand?
I want to see the truth come out and burn every one of them, and there's only one way to do that.
What is that?
Lie.
Time to tell the kids where my father came to America.
Well, can't wait till later.
You want to? The kids should hear this story.
From now on, every nun for himself.
You never guess who's come to dinner.
What?
Bodies of the recently dead are returning to life.
Tommy Gunn only fights in the ring.
Get out of here.
My ring's outside.
Villanova opens the game with a score. Harry Donahue has a recap of it. Harry?
Well, here on the sidelines, Mark, everybody is just enthusiastic because of the perfection of that opening drive. You couldn't have asked for a better job execution-wise. Everybody came out of the tunnel so emotionally charged up, but I think the one thing to note is the poise of the offense. After they got the ball on that great run back by Jeff Johnson, had a good field position, and then everybody just executed within themselves. It was a picture-perfect execution for the Wildcats offense. Good way to start this one.
7-0 Villanova, 12 minutes, 17 seconds to go in the first quarter. But keep in mind, New Hampshire is extremely potent. 7 points means absolutely nothing to this team.
Not at all, but also keep in mind the strategies played at the flip of the coin, and that was the Wildcats choosing to defer but get the win, and now we're going to see if the kickoff here by Hoffman is able to take advantage of a strong wind to his back and in fact play the strategy Coach Talley wants to do, and that is make sure New Hampshire doesn't get a real good return and great field position.
And certainly they will try to avoid Barassa if they can. They do indeed avoid Barassa as it's finally picked up by Nathan Bryan, and Bryan is snowed under by a host of Villanova defenders as he's able to snake his way to just about his own 20-yard line.
Okay, Villanova's strategy worked perfect that time, and boy, things are going their way because Hoffman's kick drops inside the goal or inside the sideline by maybe 8 or 10 yards. It could have bounced out of bounds just as easily as it bounced straight up in the air, which it did there, and the New Hampshire was not able to get the ball back to Barassa.
Keep your eye on Barassa and Perry, who has a 27-game reception streak going for New Hampshire. First and 10, it is complete in the flat. And that is Perry. John Perry, number 11, 5'10", 180-pound junior. So make it 28 straight games now as Perry on the opening play gets the pass. Andy Cobaugh, who is usually around the ball, makes the stop for Villanova.
The St. Joe's prep grad has done a great job here for the Wildcats this year. He's probably their most active defensive player along with Kevin Long and Curtis Eller. Very good at getting the football.
Second down for Griffin. The pitch to Barassa behind the blocking of fullback Mac Gallagher. And Gallagher and the offensive line do the job as they clear Villanova out of harm's way. And they're able to get a first down after their second play. Mike Brown coming up from his secondary spot, the left corner spot, to make the run out of bounds.
One of the things that you'll see from New Hampshire is very different offensive sets all game long. They'll run trips, they'll run no back offenses, two back offenses, one back offense. It's tough to defend against something like that.
Gallagher that time was off in a semi-flanker position, I guess, if you will, the fullback, as that time they gave it and tried to make a cutback play. Finally, Eller was able to make the stop against Barry Barassa.
So that was a good hard tackle by Eller. He hit Barassa. You're seeing him on the sideline there. He didn't go out of the game because of the situation. He went out of the game because he took a good, hard, high hit from Eller. He's going to have to catch his breath.
Kyle Cripps comes in to take his place at the tailback position behind fullback Mike Gallagher. No gain on the play at second and 10 for New Hampshire at their own 32. Griffin down the middle has got a man, and it is overthrown and incomplete. The open receiver was David Gamble, as he had perhaps a half a step on Oren Solomon, but it was just overthrown and out of his reach.
You're going to see Aaron Solomon. A good pass by Griffin here, but Aaron Solomon, Villanova's defensive back, he gambles a little bit on the play, and it pays off for him. If he doesn't deflect the ball, he will at least block the receiver's view, because if that ball's thrown up a little bit higher on his gamble there, Solomon, that could have been 6 points for New Hampshire.
Third and 10 for Matt Griffin, and here is the aforementioned trips formation that Drew talked about with the one back in. Griffin on third and 10. The time and the ball is batted down and incomplete. It'll bring up a fourth down. Tim Mattis, 6 foot 3 inches, 260-pound junior nose guard, got a paw on that one.
Boy, you see Mattis, he controls the middle of the line of scrimmage. Good outside contained by Oshedon. He makes the quarterback stand in the pocket now and throw, and if you get that good pressure, Mattis, good timing. But look at that agility, too. Starts with the left and comes up with the right hand like that. That's good defense.
He jumped, hung in the air almost, and then threw his arm up. Deep man is Oren Solomon. Makes the catch at his knees, and because the knee indeed hit the AstroTurf, that's where they'll have it. First and 10 at about their own 36-yard line. So University of New Hampshire gets one first down out of their opening drive, but no points. And with 10:37 to go here in the first quarter, Villanova leading New Hampshire right now 7-0.
But there's a certain sense I have watching Villanova, and you watch Solomon catch the punt, and you watch Mattis make the play he did, of a confidence. There's a certain confidence that the Villanova Wildcats seem to have so far to start off this game, that they really feel comfortable with where they're at.
Colombo again to the air on first down, and that's his first incompletion. The pass was intended to tight end Scott Donald. It'll bring up a second and 10 for Villanova.
Donald likes to run that deep square out pattern that he ran that time, but a lot of times where he's most effective is catching the ball over the middle, where the defense is spread out, they have to cover the wide receivers and respect Villanova's speed and their ability to throw that square out, and that opens up the middle a little bit more for Scott Donald.
Villanova averaging 22 points per first half this year. The sawed-off shotgun, as they like to say. The 5'7 Colombo hands it to Johnson, who gets around the end, gets the first down, gets into New Hampshire territory, and finally driven out of bounds at the 36-yard line. First down, Villanova, no flags on the big rumble by Jeff Johnson.
He's the same guy that broke Tony Dorsett's high school rushing records out in western Pennsylvania. And not great speed, but just good moves, good hard running. He outruns the secondary right there. Mike Vadera downfield does a great job, because, you know, he could clip somebody there if he gets too aggressive. He does just enough to help Johnson pick up a few yards.
Colombo on play action gets racked in his backfield and throws it, and it is intercepted by Nathan Bryan. Colombo was hit on the play. He did get rid of the ball, quite obviously, and Bryan, almost like a center fielder, makes the over-the-shoulder catch, the pass intended for Pat Friend, the interception by Colombo.
You know, that's one example where the wind could have hurt Colombo's pass that time, because the wind seemed to just take it a little bit further than Friend was able to run, and the defender had back coverage, and that is deep coverage. He did a nice job, and all he had to do is become the receiver on that play and outrun the football, which he was able to do.
And some credit to the left end, Dwayne Saab, who we talked about before the game, who has already been chosen for the East-West Shrine Game, the only one AA player to be chosen for such an honor. Here's Barassa on first and 10, and he gets some yardage as he works his way up to about the 25-yard line. It'll be a gain of around 5 for Barry Barassa, who is averaging 104 yards rushing per game this year.
He does it with speed. He does it outside the tackles. That's where he likes to run. They'll pitch the ball to him deep in the backfield. He has good enough speed that he can catch the ball out of the I-back position at 7 or 8 yards and still get to the line of scrimmage and pick up his blocks. He does not like, though, to run inside the tackles.
5 minutes gone, first quarter, 7-0 Villanova. New Hampshire with their second possession of the game. Griffin on second down. Rolls, fires. It is incomplete. Incomplete. Pass that time was intended for the tight end, Matt Chimura, and it was broken up and incomplete. It'll bring up a 3rd and 5.
Villanova's going to flush the quarterback Griffin out of the pocket there. Carbo does the job, forces him out, and now the timing of the play is off. Villanova's secondary does a great job of staying around the football and the incompletion.
Let's see what kind of 3rd and 5 formation we get from New Hampshire. It is Barassa and Gallagher still in the backfield. They ran a trips the last time with the 3 wide receivers on third down. Gamble and Perry as Griffin throws across the middle to Gallagher. He has stopped short, however, of the first down, I do believe. He had to get up to the 30-yard line. I don't think his forward progress allowed that. And it's going to bring up a fourth down, and New Hampshire is forced now to punt it away as Barry Alves was in on the coverage for the Wildcats of Villanova.
Barry Alves faked blitz, and what he was doing there was really coming up so that he could cover the back out of the backfield, which was Barassa, quickly. And he'll play off of this play. He has the back coming out at the bottom of the screen. Now he'll come off of that and make the tackle right there. That's just good hard football, and then the great pursuit by the Wildcat defense prevents the first down.
Eric Kutz out of Mountaintop, Pennsylvania. High spiral, Wynn holds it up for Solomon. At the 35, tries to run away from the flow. 40, 45, past midfield. He's got two men to beat, and he's got a blocker. Has to cut back, and he works his way inside the 30-yard line. Special teams have been the star early on for Villanova, as finally Ron Basden is able to get Solomon down, but a good return by Jeff Johnson on the kickoff, and now a good punt return by Oren Solomon. Again, excellent field position for Villanova.
Watch him fake left and then go back to his right here. He's going to fake left, reverse, and go back to the right. That helps just a little bit set up some of the blocks. And now the speed and the lanes there. And boy, big yardage for the Wildcats. Great field position again.
First and 10 at the 29 officially of New Hampshire. As on first down, Colombo keeps it on the ground that time. Kevin Mosley, who along with Smith performed very well last week against Rhode Island. Mosley ran for over 100 yards. Mosley out of Lower Merion, by the way, Ardmore, Pennsylvania. Gain on the play of about a yard. We'll call it second and 9. Colombo behind center, Tim Tarpey. Fakes, has some room, but he does not like to scramble. He throws for Donald, who grabs it at the 10-yard line. Bootleg that time for Colombo. He pulled it off nicely. Even though he has the room, he doesn't like to use it to run. That time he had Donald wide open downfield and wisely hit him with a pass.
Key to this is going to be the right tackle to Lacey, as he'll turn his man to the inside, number 72 there. Nanny looks like the intended receiver, but here comes a tight end. Villanova was in a double tight end position that time. Nobody covered Donald coming across the field.
First and 10 on the 10. I don't believe Villanova can get a first down here. But we'll see if the situation presents itself. On the carry, that's Vernon Smith. And he plunges deeper into New Hampshire territory, down to about the 5-yard line. We'll call it a second and 5. Coming up for Villanova, Chris McGrath, the senior linebacker, in on the spot. But Randy Crane opened up some nice running room that time for Smith.
Well, so far we're seeing Villanova do everything they'd like to do. They've used wide receivers, fullbacks, halfbacks, specialty teams. Colombo's done a nice job. The tight ends caught the ball. Really mixing it up very well now.
Don Ferraro, number 35, is leading Smith in the I formation here. It's Ferraro at the fullback. Second and 5. Behind Colombo, it's Smith. And he gets down to about the 2 or 3 yard line. Cats keeping it on the ground here now, close to the goal line with 7 minutes remaining in the first quarter. Eric Kutz was in on the stop there for New Hampshire.
Colombo likes to go right when he's going to either bootleg or roll out or sprint out. And then sometimes a play like we just saw with Smith coming left on the tailback position sets up what they want to do here on third and goal at the 3.
Jeff Johnson now in at fullback ahead of Smith, again in the I formation. Hart out at wide receiver. The play is for Hart, and he can't hold on. He was bumped at the last second by Nathan Bryan, and that may have kept Harold Hart, who spent a good part of the week in the hospital, from concentrating enough and able to grab the ball for the touchdown.
Yeah, tough catch. Colombo has to give it to her very quickly because he's open now, and he throws a nice hard pass. You can't throw it any better. Ball should have been caught. But again, the bad hand, you know, that you can't really blame Harold for that. He was out there open, good execution, just wasn't to be on that one.
Hart in the hospital all week with a staph infection. The coaches are running back and forth to the hospital, introducing new plays and new patterns to him. Here's Hoffman to attempt a field goal from the 9-yard line. So the 19-yarder is up from the left hash mark, and it is good. Bill Hoffman puts 3 more on the board for Villanova with 6 minutes, 28 seconds to go in the first quarter. Villanova now leading 10-0. This is the Villanova Football Network.
The Sixers swept Milwaukee in last season's playoffs, and Monday night the Bucks will be out for revenge.
It's the nonstop action of 76ers basketball, Monday night at 7:30, right here on Prism.
Hollywood movies, home team sports, a combination you can only find on Prism. It's movies like Hamlet, Reversal of Fortune, The Rookie, The Neverending Story Part 2, and The Sheltering Sky. It's the best sports lineup in Prism history, with every Flyers home game and more Sixers games than any channel on cable or broadcast TV. It's more than a movie channel. It's more than a sports channel. It's Prism this fall. Don't miss any of the action. It's the only channel you need for the best entertainment on cable TV.
Prism celebrates its 15th anniversary with its finest programming lineup ever. More Flyers and more Sixers than ever before, and more great movies. It's a fantastic fall right here on Prism.
Villanova 10, New Hampshire nothing, with Drew Gordon. I'm Mark Zumoff, and again, the special teams set up good field position. The Cats march it right in.
That and the strategy played by Coach Talley to take the wind early in the game is coming back to help him right now and get him a help to get him a 10-point lead. That and execution will work a lot of times, that combination. New Hampshire has probably not been behind much this year, but they're so explosive that I doubt whether or not Coach Bowles on the other side of the field is worried at this point. I don't think he'll have to do anything to go against his game plan. He'll stick with it. And right now what he'd like to do is get the ball. He's going to have to get something going on the ground, or at least in a short passing game.
New Hampshire's one loss came earlier this year out of conference in their opener at Marshall, 24-23. So they have won seven straight. And the Wildcats now will kick off with the wind to their backs. Bryan is number 31 and Barassa number 34 again. They want to keep it away from Barassa, who is averaging 39 yards per kickoff return. This one is taken by Mike Gallagher, who is also the starting fullback. And he brings it just across his own 25-yard line, where New Hampshire will set up shop first and 10. Coming up on the specialty team, Anthony Karanji, to make the stop on Gallagher. First and 10 for New Hampshire, with Villanova up by 10 here with 6:21 to go in the first quarter.
A little bit surprised that New Hampshire Gallagher did not try to lateral the ball back to Brass on that kickoff and have their big play guy have his hands on the football.
Well, the trips formation now with Barassa out as a wide receiver, along with Perry and Gamble. The lone setback is Gallagher, the fullback, who takes it and is immediately snowed under. So much for the trips formation as Villanova plays the run to perfection. Chris Grahowski was in there, number 92, 6'5", 263, to lead the charge for Villanova. Harry Donahue now with a fellow who'd probably rather be in the game, Pat Kennedy.
No doubt about that, Mark.
He'd rather be in the game, Pat Kennedy.
No doubt about that, Mark. Pat Kennedy is here enjoying it as best you can, right, Pat? You'd rather be out there in the midst of this battle.
Well, sir, it's kind of hard watching anything happen on the field, but Vernon and Kevin and Jeff Johnson are doing a fine job. And if you swing this way, hopefully I have a chance to come back and, you know, later on in the month and get a chance to play again.
Is you surprised by the way the offense is executed the first couple drives?
Not at all.
Looks like the defense is doing it too. Back up to you, Mark.
Kevin Long on the interception for Villanova, and again, very good field position for the Wildcats as they will take over again in New Hampshire territory. The original pass intended for John Perry.
Hey, when things bounce your way, they bounce your way, and so far for the Wildcats of Villanova, they've been going their way, and they're taking advantage of it. And that's the sign of a good team. Take advantage of the opportunities as they present themselves, because you never know when they're going to turn against you.
Well, field position has clearly been a key early on. Once again, they start a drive inside the New Hampshire 40. It's the 37, first and 10 for Colombo. Gives for Johnson, who had the wall, then ran around it. Inside the 30, down at about the 27-yard line, Jeff Johnson has run for, I believe, another Villanova first down. It's going to be close. Ron Basden coming up from his free safety spot to make the stop on Jeff Johnson. I believe it is another Villanova first down. Yes, that's the signal.
But what a great job Villanova's offensive line. Pacenti that time on the left side of the line. You're going to see and Crane. Pacenti and Crane. Watch them turn their blocks. As Johnson reads that. C77, he's on his knees there. He just turned. Prevents people from getting the outside. Boy, it's not so difficult when you can get outside like that and turn it upfield.
Johnson averaging 4.5 yards per carry with 5 minutes to go in the first quarter. Colombo in the play action. And he had to get rid of that baby, as he was being hounded by Dwayne Gordon, the right end, and Colombo just threw it away.
He sure did, and he's fortunate that probably a penalty wasn't called mm-hmm. for intentional grounding, because even though there may have been somebody near it, he was on his way down when he let it go, and a lot of times that'll be called a penalty because it's to avoid the sack, and Tommy got away with it that time, and you know, like the little gunslinger, as soon as he did it, he got back and ran away from the referee too to say, hey, you know, I'm going to the next play. Let's forget about that.
New Hampshire coach Bill Bowes is in his 20th season at New Hampshire. And Colombo will scramble, but he won't run downfield. He is good at evading tacklers, however. Not especially quick. Little swing here now. It goes to Vernon Smith. Smith is going to have some problems, and he is very inventive there around right end as he gets back to the original line of scrimmage and a bit more. Vernon Smith making the most out of a well-diagnosed play by New Hampshire. Bob Jordan among those leading the charge there.
Screen doesn't develop real good. Tommy fakes a little bit to draw the defense at him, but as he drifts towards the play, you can see the white shirts reacting very well to it, and just too hard to throw those blocks downfield like that. Smith does a nice job of picking up as much yard as he did, 1 or 2 yards, but very doable third and seven now for the Wildcats.
And the Cats converting what? Somewhere close to 50% this year on third downs. Colombo flushed out. Good coverage downfield. Doesn't like to run. Now he throws for the end zone. Hart, it is incomplete. As Nathan Bryan was right there with Hart, and Hart had an opportunity, but there it went off the fingertips and to the turf. It'll bring up a 4th and 7 now, and quite a poke coming up for Bill Hoffman.
This is one thing that we have not seen Colombo do real well this year, because he hasn't had to, and that is scramble and still make a big play. And here's Tommy. He can't see real well there, but he comes back to his left. And now he's going to tell Hart to go deep. And there he is. You can see a perfect pass up and over. Ball really should have been caught. Again, unfortunately for Howard Hart, he has that bad hand.
Hoffman with the wind to his back, a 40-yarder. It may be off to the right, I believe. Yes, it is no good. So Hoffman, who has a field goal already to his credit of 19 yards, fails that time from the right hash mark. And New Hampshire will take over 1st and 10.
Had an opportunity there to get some points again. Villanova did after Solomon's, you know, big return on the punt, doing real well there. But or that's Kevin Long's interception too. The turnovers, not able to take advantage of it this time, and they still cling to a 10-0 lead though. And still 4 minutes to go here in the first quarter.
First down. The pitch is to Barassa, and at the point of attack, Barassa is able to run up to about the 30-yard line. It's a gain on the play of around 6. It'll bring up a 2nd down now for New Hampshire. Actually, they're marking the ball now at the 28-yard line, so we'll call it a gain of 4. It'll be 2nd and 6.
Can they like to run that option when they anticipate a man-to-man defense, because that puts one man on Barassa, everybody else pretty much blocked by their man, and gives him that, hopefully those running lanes to the outside. But the Wildcat defense didn't allow too much running room for Barassa that time.
Now Gallagher, the fullback, is out on a wing as they pitch it to Barassa, who can't handle the pitch. However, he pounces on it. So the wasted down for New Hampshire, and in fact, they lose a couple of yards on the busted play. It'll bring up a 3rd down. Hoffman, by the way, with that field goal from 19, only his 2nd of the year. Check that, his 3rd of the year. And again, he missed from the right hash mark 40 yards out.
The kicking game, Villanova hasn't really needed it too often this year, and I think that's why you don't see a whole lot of attempts and or completed field goals by Hoffman. The Wildcats have been able to score a lot of touchdowns.
3rd and 7 for Matt Griffin, and New Hampshire make it a 4th down as very quickly Willie Oshedon and company snow him under, and New Hampshire will have to punt it away.
That's just great penetration. You're going to see Oshedon and Mattis, you know, the blocks, they play off of them. Missed assignments the whole bit. I think that may have even been a draw. Everybody seemed to want to go up the middle of the field, and Griffin just never got a chance to get it started.
So once again, Eric Kutz will kick it. Solomon, who already has a healthy return to his credit. Good rush by Villanova. Ball is out of bounds. Pretty good field position once again for the Wildcats, although in their home territory for a change at around the 40-yard line. Let's go down now to Harry Donahue.
Thanks, Mark. And here behind the Villanova bench, we have a guy very familiar with Villanova football, and that's Charlie Johnson. Charlie, this is a big game for Andy Talley and his crew this year, and you remember some big games back there in the early 60s when you were a Wildcat.
Yeah, I do, Harry. First of all, great to see Prism here, and certainly the best that the Philadelphia market has to offer in Harry Donahue. But, yeah, we remember sometimes the Liberty Bowl, the Sun Bowl. But this today is important because, you know, the Yankee Conference, exciting conference, probably one of the best 1AA conferences in the country. And New Hampshire's a good football team. They're not out of it yet.
Well, Villanova doing a great job. Charlie, good luck to you and all your friends here today. Big day for you.
Thank you, Harry. Good luck to you, too.
Back upstairs. Mark?
And Drew, Vernon Smith, more the east-west runner, that time goes right up the gut and gets some nice yards.
That's right. Maybe that's coming down from the booth up here. We have an easy view of things when you see the blocking by the lineman, and it appeared that Vernon maybe had some room to go inside a couple times when he receives that ball deep in the backfield, and that time he picked up 7 yards.
Second and four for Colombo as we have some movement on the line, and it looked as though New Hampshire was offside, but we'll have to wait and see. Perhaps Tim Tarpey or Mike Pacenti had moved beforehand, and it looks as though that'll be the call from Joel Goldman.
Call, false start on the offense.
An end zone shot of the official making his call. Looked like he was turned the wrong way, I thought, there for a second. And
it'll bring up a second and nine now for Villanova, as we're under 2 minutes to go in the first quarter. 1:45, clock is running. That's Pat Friend in motion. Friend with the touchdown catch that came on the opening drive of the game. A blitz and an interception, and look at this. Colombo's the only man back right now, and he's able to make the stop on the much larger Dwayne Saab. But a big defensive play for New Hampshire. They needed a break to get themselves some good field position, and indeed they do. Deep in Villanova territory, it'll be first and 10.
Colombo just doesn't throw the ball well, and he doesn't anticipate Saab's play here. He has to throw it up and over, and Saab does a great job of coming back off of the block. This is giving away 10 inches and 85 pounds right here, ladies and gentlemen. Think he's got some guts?
Now, they say Saab is a left end, but he's kind of a flexible left end, if you will. People who are somewhat amazed that an end has made an interception, he can do that kind of thing. Barassa cuts back against the grain, a fumble, and the Wildcats of Villanova think they have it. Let's see. Yes. So a terrible break for New Hampshire after they were able to get the interception. Chris Grahowski is able to fall on it for Villanova. Curtis Eller knocked it loose, and
watch
Villanova's
Eller.
Defense is able to come back and get it.
Watch
turnover.
Eller come from his inside position right here. Boom. Oshedin, that's DeMaria, I'm sorry, number 34, Phil DeMaria and Oshedin. Great job that time. That's just good hard tackling. That's why the ball came loose.
Well, the field position is not that great this time, but at least they have possession of the football. First and 10, back on their own 9-yard line, as most assuredly they'll keep it on the ground here and try to get themselves out of the hole. But right there, Smith, as he tests the right corner, is turned right back. Chris McGrath, as we said, he has been their leading tackler. He's been hobbled by some foot problems, but I don't think he nor Jeff Oliva, who's also been injured at the left tackle, they were going to miss this game, the most important game of the year, certainly for either team. With first place at stake, New Hampshire right now unbeaten. Villanova and Delaware each with a loss. Delaware, by the way, playing Connecticut today. We'll have a score for you as we get it. From the eye, it's second and 10 for the Wildcats, still at about their own 9-yard line. Fumble of the football, Colombo recovers. And with that greeting party, he wisely falls on it. Chris McGrath and a host of others were just standing there waiting to gang up on him. And Colombo said, all right, guys, I'll end it right here.
Okay, strategy here, 25 seconds to go. Villanova probably will use a timeout so that they can punt the ball away with the wind to their backs. There's 19 seconds. See the ratios. Villanova on a plus 7 this year, New Hampshire plus 4. Good football by both teams. But again, the Wildcats, unless they're not going to concern themselves deep in their own territory, you might think that they would want to play to punt the ball into the wind, but don't seem to really matter. Doesn't seem to matter right now.
Part of that turnover ratio is the fact that Colombo has only thrown 9 interceptions this year against 16 touchdown passes. And on the 3rd and 13, the first quarter comes to a close. It has been a successful one thus far for Tom Colombo and his Villanova Wildcats. The special team starring, and Colombo going to Pat Friend, a field goal coming. And that's been it. 10-0 Villanova leading New Hampshire on this, the Villanova Football Network. Villanova Wildcat Football on Prism is brought to you by McGowan Lincoln Mercury Isuzu. Go west to McGowan. By Budweiser, Beechwood Age for that cool, clean, crisp taste. For all you do, this Bud's for you. And by your Quality Plus Ford dealer.
So we're enjoying our favorite spot, and we see this old guy.
Hey, Bubs!
Then there was this huge wave. We thought the old guy was history. That was hot. Anyway, we were impressed.
Guru Dude, want a cold bud?
Groovy!
Groovy!
Despite our language differences, all surfers share a universal communication.
Oops.
Whoa.
Buying a new car can be a hazardous road to travel, with lots of confusing signals. So where do you go for the best deal? Which way do you turn for friendly service? There's only one direction. Go west to McGowan. Great prices and friendly service. McGowan Lincoln Mercury Isuzu in Westchester.
Yeah!
Go west to McGowan.
I like Villanova very much. What it does very well. I love the size of it. I don't think it's intimidating, but yet it's sophisticated. I am very pleased with the variety of faces I'm seeing more and more on campus. And I do think it has a well-deserved reputation for having a lot of fun, and I say that in all the best ways.
After the opening 15, Villanova leading 10-0, and Harry Donahue, field position was the key in the opening quarter, wasn't it?
I think so, Mark. So far, it's been all Villanova, and really the special teams have set it up. The opening kickoff by Johnson gave them great field position on the first drive. Solomon's punt return also helped out. The only time that New Hampshire's crossed midfield was on the interception. And Drew, to pick up something that you said about Tommy Colombo, I think he had a tough time, really. He never saw Saab. The rush by, I believe it was Oliva first, and when he got rid of the ball, he never saw Saab right behind Oliva. Back upstairs.
And Villanova now facing the win on a 3rd and 13, so they keep it on the ground. The Smith, as he runs for the sticks, and he's got the first down. What a play by Vernon Smith as he just outran the pursuit. Bob Jordan finally met him at the sideline, but not before Smith was able to get a big first down on 3rd and 13.
Shovel pass by Colombo now in the shotgun. He just pitches the ball, and Vernon Smith with great speed, good blocking. Johnson there on the corner just tangles people up, and so Smith's speed works to their advantage. You know, Coach Bo said that this week, that Vernon Smith's speed could really help the Wildcats and make up a little bit, a lot for the loss of Kennedy.
Opening moment, second quarter, and now some breathing room on the play action. Colombo with some time, fires complete to Johnson at the 35, and he crosses the 35 up to around the 37-yard line. Jeff Johnson, who along with running is able to curl out of the backfield. That's his 15th reception of the year, and another first down for Villanova.
Colombo at his best, and the maturity of Villanova's experienced people at their best there too. Colombo, again, doesn't lose his cool, doesn't panic, throw the ball out of bounds, takes what's there. Johnson, the veteran, he knows how to get open. He doesn't panic. He waits until people clear him, and he cuts back, and Colombo finds him.
First and 10 for the Villanova Wildcats at their own 38-yard line. Jeff Johnson, the lone setback. He gets the call on the delay across the 40-yard line up to around the 42, a gain of about 3, maybe 4 in the play before Eric Coots is able to make the stop.
First quarter statistics, Wildcats dominating 103 yards to 28. They've controlled the ball with the 5 first downs. Look at time of possession, they're leading there. Turnovers, they lead. Penalties, only one penalty so far. But again, Wildcats have held a potent offense to only 28 yards in the first half. That's great.
And only 18 yards rushing for a team that averages, what, something like 180 or 190 yards per game on the ground? On 2nd and 6, it's Colombo. That one is batted down. Good play by Steve Dunn, the nose guard, 6'3", 260 pounds, number 76, to swat that Colombo pass out of the way.
Okay, one of the strategies, you know, that New Hampshire's playing defensively up front is maybe not being so intent on rushing Colombo as get position and then jump, as he has to try to throw the ball from the pocket. And it's been effective two or three times today, once leading to the interception. Harry indicated when Colombo just didn't see the defensive end because of the rush, and that's the second deflection we've seen.
Third and six on the 42. Minute and a half gone here on the second quarter. Villanova up 10-0. New Hampshire needs a stop. Colombo to the pocket. Able to find Scott Donald. Does he have the first down? Boy, does he ever. As he bulls his way, carrying tackler and all, that was Dwayne Gordon. He was dragging 6'2", 230, along with his own 6'5", 250-pound frame.
He's just a tough guy, and again, he catches the ball coming out of his tight end position. He just finds openings in the zone. And if you see, it doesn't look like they're rushing real hard. They just want it. They're trying to get their hands up. But the Wildcats do a great job. And Donald knows what he needs. Drops the shoulder, power against power. Donald had more momentum. He picks up the first down by about 4 yards.
Donald, the leading receiver for Villanova this season out of Sun Valley High School. First and 10. Just inside New Hampshire territory at the 47. This is Smith again up the gut. Penalty flags fly as Smith works his way inside the 45-yard line. The preliminary indication is holding against Villanova.
I think that's going to be your final two. That's an easy one, thrown right in the middle of the line on a draw play. We'll hear from the official right now.
Holding on the offense.
So the Wildcats are going to be marched back here.
And Villanova has averaged a little bit over 10 penalties per game. That's their second one today. They've also averaged 84.5 yards per game in penalties, and this will be 10 marked off from the point of the infraction. That's going to be 15 yards today. So the Wildcats, although having only one first down for 5 yards in the first quarter, well below their average, this is the kind of thing that has stymied an offense that's been so potent. It hasn't stymied it much at all. It's held it back a little bit, but not something they can afford a lot of today against New Hampshire.
Up at Storrs, by the way, it is Delaware 14, Connecticut 3. They're in the second quarter. Remember, New Hampshire 5-0, Villanova and Delaware both 5-1 in the Yankee Conference. From the eye, this is Smith, finds the corner, has some running room, and he gets back to the original line of scrimmage and more, maybe steps out of bounds at around the 45-yard line. So Smith is able to get the penalty yardage back and more as he works his way up to the New Hampshire 45.
We have another flag on the play. It's going to be against the Wildcats. You know, some of those plays we talked about earlier where they were able to get to the outside on the good blocks, here's the call. Holding again by Pisani and Lacey, particularly as they were able to turn people. You know, a lot of times to do that, you have to hold, you know, and maybe now they're being caught on it a little bit after some complaining by New Hampshire. But this is the kind of thing that you just hate to see, you know, as a coaching staff, because, you know, and Coach Talley very concerned. Same plays I ran in the first quarter worked real well. Now they appear to work, and the penalty flags are bringing everything back.
And Bill Lacey, who was questionable coming into this game with a bad back, he had been working with a chiropractor all week long, one of their best blockers out of the right tackle position, is now out of the game. And Sean Downs, he himself questionable with a foot problem, is in the game now in his place. Downs at 6'6", 263. Villanova lining up now with a first down and 30 on their own 34-yard line. Johnson leading Smith in the I formation. Colombo over Tim Tarpey. Sets, fires down the sideline. He has Friend on Bryant. It is caught but out of bounds. Caught but out of bounds. Good reception by Friend. It looked good, except it didn't count. And we'll call it a second and 30 now for Villanova.
It's a great catch by Pat Friend on the sideline here. The play's really not there. Colombo shows a strong arm, good blocking. He gets it out there, but pretty good defense too. The ball's on the outside shoulder where it belongs. Just one step too much though for Friend, as he wasn't able to get his foot down inbounds to make the completion.
Harold Hart is now in at one wide receiver spot along with George Brown, who is just inside him. Colombo looking Hart's way, and Hart had it and just had it go through his hands. Harold Hart had that football and it just slipped through his hands. Perhaps a lack of concentration on his part. Anyway, it'll bring up a third and 30 now with 12:38 to go here in the second quarter.
Again, the Wildcats very difficult now with third and impossible. You know, third and real long yardage like that, there's nothing in the playbook. You successfully here sometimes a if you have the defense playing loose because they don't want to give up a big play, a draw, maybe a shovel pass, or maybe just a toss back to the I back and see if he can't find a seam and try to get some yardage to make the punt possible.
Colombo keeps it on the ground here with 28 yards to go on third down. And the Villanova Wildcats will give it up to the New Hampshire Wildcats. Joe Fleming in on that stop of number 44, Vernon Smith. So an important stop for New Hampshire, and Villanova really causing themselves some problems as they started out in New Hampshire territory and then a couple of holding penalties, and that left them back in their own territory. Hoffman punts it away, low wobbly kick, and Brian falls on it at about his own 20-yard line. And now a penalty goes down, and it looks as though we might have a piling on flag against Villanova. So the flags are flying here at Villanova, and the penalties have been against the home Wildcats.
Well, they're going to call piling on there, but and I think the reason they're going to call is because Murray had his head down, not because of the timing of the call, but it didn't look like he had his head down to a spear. He wanted, like, went for the football, see if he could knock it loose. Anytime a guy drops a punt like that, he didn't spear him. He was going for the football to make sure he was down, and unfortunately, a fast flag that time and personal foul call.
Well, the Villanova fans clearly upset with the call, but it goes against their Wildcats. First and 10 for the New Hampshire Wildcats on their own 37-yard line. Matt Griffin at quarterback. New Hampshire in the eye. The give is to the first man through. That's the reserve fullback, Lee McClinton, who was in there for the first time. Not much running room for him as Chris Krahowski leads the charge for Villanova on that stop.
There's like five or six flags in a row now, and, you know, and the officials, hopefully these things run in streaks and it stops soon because it stops all the continuity of the football game. This one happens to be against New Hampshire, but Villanova had the two or three calls and then piling on and personal foul, and now this call, sometimes it can get out of hand too. Villanova, four penalties, three of them in the second quarter, and also for 38 yards.
On the offense, first down.
I can only think, Drew, that this early in the game, maybe the officials are trying to establish something here early in the second, trying to keep things clean and let them know how they're going to call it so things don't bog down later in the game.
Hopefully, you know, the one thing that you look for from the officials, especially in these types of calls, is consistency. Mm-hmm. If you're going to let them do it in the first quarter, you're going to have to let them do it in the fourth quarter, too, and maybe that's what they are trying to do, control it a little bit.
And just about all those penalties have been in the last few minutes. 11 and a half to go in the second, first and 20 for New Hampshire. Barassa, the fake on the play action, now gets it back. Has a couple of blockers upfield, but unblocked goes Oren Solomon, who trips him up at the 30-yard line. Gain on the play of about four. Archbishop Carroll's Oren Solomon up from his right corner to make the stop.
Defensive coach Dan McNeil, along with defensive back coach Dan Fidler, have to really be happy with this play. This is good discipline and good execution. Nice play by New Hampshire. Look at Solomon break through the blocks and come in and make a nice open field tackle on a great football player. Good play by Solomon that time. And boy, if you're coaching that position, you got to feel good that you did it right this week.
Barassa had 310 all-purpose yards last week in a win against Boston University. Of course, we're talking about receiving, return, and rushing yards as well. Griffin. And it is intercepted. Is it intercepted? Barry Alvis laying on his back has the football for Villanova.
Nice play by Alvis. We're going to see just a great play at the end as he'll deflect the ball away on just a short sprint out on a bootleg. And Alvis is going to reach his right hand out. Ball deflects, bounces off his leg. He catches it between his legs. Just like he thought it was going to be before the play, he projected that in his mind and makes the play.
Is there a drill for that? First and 10 on the 34. Again, excellent field position for the Wildcats. The pitch for Smith. Looks for the right corner around it, but closing it very quickly on a nice pursuit play was Ron Basden to chase down Vernon Smith.
It didn't look like Smith was going to gain any yardage on the play, but he was able to get the ball down to the 31-yard line and pick up three on the play. Bazin does a good job of coming up from a safety position to make the play, but Smith's speed again, pretty good blocking on the right side of Villanova's line, moved the defensive line for New Hampshire downfield and picked up 3 or 4 yards.
Second and 7, ball on the New Hampshire 31 with 5 minutes gone in the second. It's Villanova 10, New Hampshire nothing. Colombo rolls, fires, and it is beyond the reach of the receiver there in the left flat. Pass that time was intended for Scott Thompson. Is that correct?
That's
Scott,
right,
Thompson, who's been out a good part of the year with a stress fracture, is in there.
Yeah, surprise, surprise, and Scotty's limping off the field right now, and he has one of those real small bones in his foot, supposedly either fractured or at least, you know, and not up to where it should be, and that's a very painful injury to play with.
Well, I was thrown for a loop. I did not expect to see Scott Thompson in there at all. Third and 7, Colombo under a rush, looks, fires, he's got Donald, but he overthrew him. And Colombo was rushed that time, and he couldn't quite throw it up there in the timing scheme of things to get it to Donald. Dwayne Saab was in there, breathing down his neck.
Villanova's inadvertent flag, evidently they, again, the flag falls out of the official's pocket, and thought that was going to be an ineligible receiver downfield against the Villanova Wildcats that time, because sometimes that will happen when the quarterback scrambles around and doesn't get the pass off as quickly as he needs to.
Fourth down here and into the wind, Villanova's going to go for it. Hoffman missed earlier with the wind at his back from 40, although it wasn't short, it was wide right. And Colombo doesn't like what he sees here, and he elects to call a timeout. 9 minutes and 51 seconds to go. Second quarter from Villanova. It's 10-0 on the Villanova Football Network.
I think the traditional values that Villanova has offered, both emotionally, spiritually, intellectually, and physically, are important, and they're going to remain important. I think if we were to go on in society and develop as we want to in the 21st century, these values will become even more important.
A rich Catholic tradition with learning enhanced by values.
Hollywood movies, home team sports, a combination you can only find on Prism. It's movies like Goodfellas, Bonfire of the Vanities, Avalon, and Rocky V, uncut, unedited, uninterrupted, and commercial-free. It's the best sports lineup in Prism history, with more Flyers and Sixers games than any channel on TV. It's more than a movie channel. It's more than a sports channel. It's Prism this fall. It's the only channel you need for the best entertainment on cable TV.
And with 9:51 to go, along with Drew Gordon, I'm Mark Zumoff. Harry Donahue is on the sidelines. 10-0 Villanova. They're faced now with a fourth down at the New Hampshire 31-yard line going into the wind.
Tough call here, fourth and 7. Wide side of the field to the left. Colombo is not as comfortable sprinting out to the left or rolling out to the left as he is to his right. Villanova with the one tight end, two backs in the backfield. So right now it's going to be interesting to see where they go. Probably to the tight end. I'd look for Donald.
Friend and Lumpkin, also the receivers. Blitz. Under a rush. Colombo looks, fires. Donald is there. He has it, and he has enough for the first down as he gets inside the 15-yard line. Dwayne Gordon there on the coverage, but Scott Donald able to find an opening, and Colombo with good patience is able to find him downfield.
Again, the poise of Colombo as he gets away from the rush. It's an outside rush, and he gets to the outside, and he does a nice job. He knows where he's throwing the ball, and he saw the big tight end. Give credit to Donald, too. Quarterback in trouble. He knows where to go to get in the quarterback's sight to get open to receive the pass.
Chris McGrath, the linebacker, was up blitzing, and he forced Colombo to his right. And as Drew mentioned, Colombo is more comfortable throwing to his right anyway. As Smith goes right up the middle that time, gets about 3 or 4 yards down to about the 10-yard line. Vernon Smith behind John Maracek, the right guard. Let's go down now to Harry Donahue, who's on the sidelines. Harry?
Well, the last couple times that Colombo has looked for Scott Donald, Colombo's been really isolated against two left ends. He had Saab one time, and the other time he had the big number 87, Dwayne Gordon. Their ends really line up as linebackers, but I think they've found a weakness there in the defense. Mark?
Vernon Smith found some sort of weakness right there off of right tackle. He follows Bill Lacey, who's back in the game, and Lacey's able to clear a path to the end zone. Touchdown, Villanova.
Boy, they're executing well on offense. Just a toss back to Smith. Watch Craig Johnson, 28. Big block at the line of scrimmage. Cut back. Lacey takes his man to the outside. Missed tackles, which is good running. Pat Friend from his outside position, he takes care of the defensive back, and Vernon Smith able to celebrate as he crosses the goal line.
Bill Hoffman in to tack on the extra point. Out of the hold of Colombo. It is good. There is a timeout here at homecoming. Villanova Stadium with 8:48 to go. Villanova up 17-0, and the key there, Drew, was the fourth down play, the fourth and seven, as Colombo found his tight end, Scott Donald.
Well, again, statistics sometimes lead you to know what the strength of a team is, and Villanova has been 50% on conversions this year on third down, so taking the gamble on fourth down, good call strategy-wise. Too far for a field goal, nothing going to accomplish on a punt. Good execution by the key players of Villanova's team. And again, Jeff Johnson, the big fullback, clears the way on the pitch back to Vernon Smith. He's able to cut back and score the touchdown. And you know, to win the big games and do well against the good teams, you have to execute when the ball's on, you know, game's on the line, it's crunch time.
We would like to make you aware of the 7th annual Andy Talley Villanova Football Camp, 1 week of non-contact football from Sunday through Thursday, June 21st to 25th. It's a day of or overnight football camp for boys between the ages of 10 and 18 who are interested in improving their football skills. Villanova selected some of their scholarship players from this camp. Coach Talley, his entire coaching staff, and some of the area's top high school football coaches providing instruction on all the basic football skills. The program adjusts to the campers' football experience, and special attention is given to those young boys who are just being introduced to organized football. For further camp information and to receive a special 10% early registration discount, call the Villanova football office at 215-645-4105. That's 215-645-4105 for the 1992 Andy Talley Villanova football camp. 8:48 to play here in the second quarter, and Villanova has jumped on top 17-0, something we did not expect, but field position has done it for them and some key plays as well. As Hoffman kicks off into the wind, and Barassa for the first time will field it. Again, averaging 39 a return. That time faked it to Nathan Bryan around the right side up to the 30, and he's finally pulled down at around the 34-yard line. That time faking it on the play to Nathan Bryan, keeping it is Barry Barassa. Finally, Delman Robertson is able to run him out of bounds.
Boy, nice play by Robertson. Delman Robertson, number 53 for the Wildcats, because we just saw there why he averages 39 yards per return. Not only is his running ability, but boy, he gets some great blocking and good scheme by the New Hampshire kickoff return team, as they almost were able to break a big one on that one.
Matt Griffin, whose offense thus far has been shut out by this tough Villanova defense. 8:38 to play in the second. They could use a score. Under a rush, fires. It is complete to Gallagher, the fullback, who has himself a first down. Mike Gallagher curling out of the backfield that time. His 21st reception on the year. Kevin Long, the strong safety, is there on the coverage.
Watch Danny Summers at the top of the screen, number 99 for the Wildcats. He's going to get in Griffin's face, and maybe if he gets his hands up there, right there, he prevents the pass from being completed, but nice play by Griffin to find the open zone and find his receiver.
Be interesting to see now, New Hampshire unbeaten in the Yankee Conference, successful in their last seven, how they react being down here. They have won many of their games this year handily. They have not faced a 17-0 hole all year. Pass again to Gallagher, and it is complete. And again, it's another first down as New Hampshire's moving here as they get inside Villanova territory now to about the 41-yard line. Curtis Eller is in on the tackle for Villanova.
Well, New Hampshire's a very good football team, too, and they realize now down 17-0 that they have to do something offensively. And at least on these last two plays, we've seen some nice execution, big yardage, and they're reacting to that challenge right now.
Griffin has John Perry to one side and David Gamble to the other, but out of the eye, it is Barassa. This time they sniff out the play, and he has stopped. However, he gets inside the 40. Mike Jones, an inside linebacker for Villanova, credited that time for the tackle.
We haven't really seen a whole lot of consistency from New Hampshire's offense yet. They haven't really come up with that pet player, that pet guy to go to, at least that's been successful here this afternoon. They're still searching for that now, but twice now they've been successful with a pass out to the, you know, from the hash mark out to the sideline.
Mike Cranny now in the game at the split end, replacing Gamble for New Hampshire. As Griffin across the middle has Perry on the little play, and Perry is just short of the first down as he works up to about the 32-yard line. Little crossing pattern that time. Right up the line of scrimmage goes Perry. Kevin Long was in on the coverage for Villanova as Perry just kind of sneaked his way into the Villanova secondary.
Looked like a couple guys from Villanova, including number 50, Cobo, missed him as they reacted. Little screen over the middle as Griffin drops back, draws the defense in. You can see everybody let the blue jerseys go. Here comes 50, Cobo. He just misses. Timing just a little bit off on the play, but fortunately Kevin Long and other Villanova defenders come over to make the tackle.
Big third and two coming up for New Hampshire. The line is tight, and they go to the money man. Barassa fumbles the football. It is recovered by Long, but I believe they say he was down. Long scooped it up and had ideas of going for the goal line, but they say Barassa had the first down, was down, and New Hampshire will retain possession.
Fast whistle. See if you can see if his knee's down. He's down. One thing that they do call, especially on AstroTurf, is if they feel that the turf has anything to do with the ball bouncing loose, they'll call it was down, and he was down before the ball came loose that time.
So New Hampshire putting together perhaps their most consistent drive of the afternoon, and they need it here, down 17-0 with 6.5 to go in the second quarter. Griffin again for Barassa, straight ahead, runs into Willie Oshadin and company, fumble. Kevin Long indicating that Villanova has this one, but the officials are indicating otherwise. New Hampshire will retain possession.
But they're going for the football. You know, one thing that is noticeable out there with Krahowski and Oshadin especially, Willie's doing a great job. They're really manhandling Barassa out there. He's a little guy, 5'7", 165 pounds. His asset is his speed, not his power. And they're just doing a good job trying to manhandle him, like grab him up high and, you know, see if they can't shake the ball loose from his hands and recover the fumble.
And this is no shrimpy offensive line for New Hampshire either. They average 270 pounds across. Clock is running, 5:45 to go on second and eight. Griffin being flushed out by Summers. Looks and fires. It is incomplete. Gallagher, who caught the first two passes on this drive, unable to snare that one. It'll bring up a third and eight.
Good defense again by Villanova Wildcats. They flush Griffin out of the pocket and force him right. He looks like he is more comfortable standing in the pocket throwing the football than he is rolling to his right or left. At 6'3", 200 pounds, no wonder. You know, you can stand back there, but the Wildcats doing a nice job of getting that good pressure up the middle.
And we'll see if they don't tee off here on the third and eight with the ball on the 27-yard line. Gallagher, the lone setback, as Barassa goes out to a wing in the trips formation left. Griffin on third down. No receivers, now fires. Perry has it, and it is incomplete. I'm not sure if Long tipped it or not. He seems upset with himself in that maybe he could have intercepted it. Perry, in the meantime, thought he had an opportunity to turn and go for the touchdown.
It's called good timing is what it is. Kevin Long does a great job. Great blocking by New Hampshire's offensive line, all 275 pounds per average of them. Griffin really can rifle it out here now. And Kevin Long, boy, nice play. If the receiver comes back one step, he probably makes the catch. Kevin Long does a good job of getting there and knocking it down.
Fourth and eight, New Hampshire needs points. At the Villanova 27, here they go. Again, trips formation to the left. Gallagher, the lone setback, he's the fullback. Behind Griffin, again, it's a fourth down. Back, he fires, it is intercepted by Long. Intercepted by Kevin Long, who's still on his feet. Finally tripped up at the 32-yard line, but Villanova with a big turnover on the fourth down with just over 5 minutes to go in the fourth quarter. The 17-0 lead is safe.
Okay, we're going to get down to Harry Donahue right now. He has somebody else on the sideline.
All right, Drew, I just wanted to mention that we've seen a lot of the dimensions of this Barassa. We've heard about him as a kickoff returner, and that last time he was able to set up pretty good field position for New Hampshire. But something else I think that's sometimes overlooked, and maybe we can watch it, he's a great blocker. Watch how he can really pick up a linebacker or a corner coming in, and he's also a tremendous blocker. He does everything so well.
Right now, the Villanova offense has turned a block for Vernon Smith, who looks to cut back. The hole is closed quickly by New Hampshire. Gain on the play of three by Vernon Smith. So Long, ironically, on the play previous, he thought he had an interception and was upset at himself. That time, he is able to come up with the INT as Matt Griffin throws it there on a fourth down. And with 5 minutes to go here, perhaps we'll see Villanova play a little ball control, up 17-0.
Well, ironically, on that play, and surprisingly, I think, better to say, is that New Hampshire went back to the same play that, that Long had been effective to knocking down the play before and made the interception. They had the trips out there, and I guess they just thought that they could get a quick short pass out on the sideline.
Here's Colombo, so much for ball control as he goes to throw it up, and it is batted down by Steve Dunn. Dunn, the nose guard, has been very active in that department today.
He's the guy with the blood all over his pants. They can pick him out real easy. He's doing a good job. His job is not to rush the quarterback. His job is to play along the line of scrimmage, stay in his sight, and jump. And Tommy's the passes that have been knocked down today for Colombo have all been out when he's dropped back and stayed in the pocket. When he's rolled or sprinted to the sidelines or done his bootleg plays, he's been able to find the lanes and deliver the football.
Third and seven with 4.5 to go in the second. 17-0 Villanova. Both wide receivers now, or both running backs into the secondary. Pass for Friend, and he has it down at the 32-yard line. First down on a third down play. Again, Nathan Bryan is victimized. Pat Friend is able to pull in the pass from Colombo.
You know, when you play that soft rush on Colombo, he'll drop back out of the shotgun. Good view. He sees the corner breaking. There's nobody near him, and he's able to deliver the ball well that time. That's into a strong wind, people. And that you can't throw it any better than that. Pat Friend makes a great catch in between the defensive backs and another big play for the Villanova offense.
Friend, who caught the touchdown pass on the opening drive, hauls that one in. First and 10 on the New Hampshire 33. Strawn Lumpkin, number 8. He's the wide receiver in action. Fake to Smith. Colombo to his left. Pitches it out for Johnson, who's able to grab it and work his way down to around the 27-yard line. As you say, Colombo uncomfortable going to his left, so he sort of pitched it to Johnson, and Johnson is able to get some decent yardage out of it.
That's exactly right, Mark. He comes out here, and he'd rather not have to turn his shoulders and flick it with his arm. He's just going to do what they do in an option play. Same execution, so he doesn't feel it's dangerous at all. Johnson does a great job of finally catching the ball before the defenders come in.
We call that UBE, ugly but effective. With 3.5 to go, a second and 3 now for the Wildcats. New Hampshire showing blitz. Smith tries right tackle, and he may have the first down here as he gets inside the 25. He had to get to the 23. Dwayne Saab was in there filling the gap for New Hampshire.
Colombo 11 for 22, 106 yards here in the first half, a little bit below his average, but again, he's very effective on the plays. You know, he's converted a lot of third and fourth down plays here, and he's been effective on the touchdown. You know, and if you look back, with the ball dropped in the end zone, you know, with Hart on the short pass, that's a difference of 4 points because Villanova covered the field goal, and then the missed pass by Hart, you know, they really could easily have another 10 points here.
Third and one in the I formation. Double tight ends. Straight ahead is Smith and Moore as he gets inside the 20. A Villanova first down as he's brought down at the 18 by Dwayne Gordon.
But this first half is also indicating, too, that this is a complete team play, as you're going to see. The defense is doing their job. They're making the turnovers. The Wildcat offensive line is doing a super job of controlling the line of scrimmage, also doing a good job of, you know, protecting Colombo. He's effective, you know, completing the passes. There's been some nice catches and some very fine runs.
And time marches on. 2.5 to play in the second quarter. Smith. That time Steve Dunn was able to trip him up as he got to about the line of scrimmage. Maybe a yard for Vernon Smith. As the Wildcats keep it on the ground there on first down, and some changes now as Friend and George Brown come out of the game.
We have a double tight end situation here for the Wildcats.
Mike Vidaro making his first appearance at the flanker spot. And Bill Lacey is coming into the game. Lacey, I think, is being given some periods of rest here because of that back problem.
Villanova's not going to run a play here. They're going to either take the penalty or probably call the timeout with 2 seconds to go here on the play clock. But they did get the clock down to a minute and 45, and they're really executing and playing the clock now, making sure New Hampshire doesn't get the ball back with too much time.
We have 1:45 on that third quarter clock. Villanova 17-0 on the Villanova Football Network.
As we sit here in 1991 and look forward, it is clear that Villanova University has attained prominent national status as a leader in many academic disciplines. And for the school to continue such momentum and growth, it's key that the fundraising campaign, which it's about to embark upon, be very, very successful so that the university can have the capital or the endowment to sustain and to continue this momentum that has been so widely acclaimed.
The sun? No sun. It's overcast. It's blustery. It is chilly, but the warmth of homecoming very evident here at Villanova. Stoked most notably by a 17-0 Villanova Wildcat lead with 1:45 to go in the second quarter.
This is important right now, though. The Wildcats, you know, with the ball down inside the 20, you know, it's not that they can put the game away right now, but boy, you go in there 24-0 instead of 17-0 at halftime, and it makes a big difference on the psychological way you come out in the second half.
Tom Colombo now calling a timeout, and that was the last one for Villanova with a minute 45 to go. Why do you think he did that?
He's confused. He's upset about something, and Coach Talley's upset about something. I got to believe one of the players on the field, somebody on the line or lined up incorrectly or didn't understand the play or whatever, so they had to waste a timeout here, which is a shame. They're out for the half now, and yet they have plenty of time left. A minute and 45, they're inside the 20-yard line at the 17, and Colombo just made a decision there that he wasn't going to give up 5 yards and a penalty or a poorly executed play on 2nd and 9, and he'll waste a timeout instead.
The Villanova Wildcats close out their 1991 regular home schedule with the University of Massachusetts next Saturday, November 16th at 1:30. There is no better way to experience just how exciting this year's Villanova team is than to see them in person. Good seats available. For tickets, call 645-4100, 645-4100, as Massachusetts comes in for the final Yankee Conference game of the year for Villanova. Then they will be at Fordham to close out the regular schedule. That'll be on November 23rd. 2nd and 9, and now they line it up with no timeouts remaining. As Smith is out on a wing, Colombo looks that way. Friend curling under, he has it, and he has run out of bounds at the 14-yard line. All that to gain maybe 3 yards. Bob Jordan chasing Friend out of bounds.
Don't think that play wasn't used, though, to set something else up. And when you run a play like that, Friend maybe wanted to be a little bit deeper, but he was going out of bounds to catch the ball, so they had to stop the clock. That was important. But with that trips, it's a lot of times a play like that is called, and the coaching staff up top's looking for the adjustment to it, how they're going to play that inside the 20-yard line, and now I'm sure they have a play to counter it.
Okay, let's see what happens on 3rd and 6 with Johnson and Smith poised to curl out of the backfield and run some patterns. Indeed they do, as Colombo is flushed out. Looking to the left, has a man, and he's being chased, and he throws it up, and it is out of bounds.
That's okay, because he didn't give up anything right there. Now, into a tough win, Coach Talley's going to elect, as we see Hoffman come onto the field, to try the field goal. I guess with the time left, a minute and 30, and he feels that 36 yards, as the ball will be marked on the 19, that he feels that even into this win, that Hoffman can make this.
Hoffman has one field goal to his credit. He's 1 for 2 today. He missed from 40 yards out. He made it from 19. The one he missed was from the right hash mark. Again, directly into a win. A 31-yarder out of Colombo's Holden. It is blocked. It is blocked by Dwayne Gordon. So New Hampshire prevents further bloodshed here as they block the field goal attempt by Hoffman, and now they take over with a minute and 19 to march to try to get some kind of score here. They have some good field position now up at their own 42-yard line.
Okay, New Hampshire's a good football team, and we can't forget that, and that's why their record is 7-1. They're undefeated in the Yankee Conference. They've had a couple times here that they could have let this game get out of hand, and they fought back, and in a play like that, Hoffman tries to drive the ball. Good reaction, a good penetration. They block the field goal, thwart a score, and maybe give themselves a chance to get some points before halftime.
Matt Griffin, as Villanova fakes the blitz, and right there, Barry Alves was looking to intercept that one. as John Donnelly, the reserve tight end, was going up the middle, and Griffin threw it over everyone's head. Second and 10 with 1:15 now to go on the clock. New Hampshire with all three of their timeouts remaining here in the second quarter.
Yeah, they should not be in a hurry. I'm a little bit surprised at Griffin on that play, that he threw the ball as quickly as he did. He's got plenty of time, and he does have all his timeouts left. He's got a strong wind to his back. To get points, he probably only has to get the ball inside the 25-yard line.
And they are lining tailback Barry Barasa up as a wide receiver. That's Perry in motion. Griffin on second down. Summers slams him as he throws it out for Barasa. It is incomplete. But Dan Summers put a hurting on Matt Griffin that time. Third and 10 coming up for New Hampshire.
Griffin, who did not play last week for New Hampshire, has a bad knee, a bad left knee. We see a brace on it out in the field, but you do a couple of those blindside shots to any quarterback standing back there in the pocket, and he got up trying to make sure his shoulder blades were still in place after that hit.
Villanova, that 5-for-10 is just about their average for the year, believe it or not. Third and 10 for New Hampshire, down 17-0, a minute 10 to go in the second quarter. Griffin for Barasa, intercepted by Alves. Another interception for the Villanova secretary. That time Barry Alves is able to get it and prevent New Hampshire from any ideas of any sort of score here in the first half. So more than likely, the Wildcat defense will record a shutout for the opening 30.
Great play by the defense, decent penetration, but he's got time to throw. He looks like he holds back a little bit there, and receiver Brass is not even open. You have Chuck Long, you had Kevin Long, and you have Alves playing it perfectly, and Villanova's defense doing the job making the interception. That one just looked a lot easier probably than it was. It was good execution by the defense that made it appear so easy.
A more conventional interception for Alves, who the last time caught one on his back between his legs and was able to somehow come up with it. And turnover is a key for Villanova and their defense here in the first half. Minute four to go, and how about this? Colombo is going to put it up top. He has Smith, gets around a man, and is run out of bounds at about the 41-yard line. Well, up 17-0 and in their own territory. Andy Talley showing no signs of conservatism here whatsoever.
Not at all, and that also reflects, I think, that his confidence in his offensive team as well as the personality of the team. Colombo's a little bit of a gambler. They have some big play people out there, and Vernon Smith and Pat Friend, who's done a great job here this afternoon. So, you know, why not go for it a little bit? As long as you have a good poised quarterback with a good head who doesn't take an unnecessary risk right now, nothing wrong with throwing the football.
Second and four. The backs Johnson and Smith run their patterns. This one is for Smith, and Colombo intentionally threw it away there as Smith was very closely covered in the secondary by Sean Curry.
Colombo needed just, I think, an extra second on that play to make it work. He didn't have to give the receiver enough time really to clear the opposition, the defensive back on that one, as he would like to. Vernon Smith with his speed needed a little bit more time, and maybe he would have been able to spring open and the ball been completed.
Well, I guess you like the aggressive strategy as long as it works and it doesn't hurt you in any way. Certainly it delivers a message to the other team trying to come back 17-0. Colombo to the air for Friend, and it is intercepted. It's intercepted by Nathan Bryan. So as we had talked about it not hurting you, indeed the turnover for New Hampshire, not only 44 seconds still to go, but they have all three timeouts remaining here in the second quarter.
And that's not the fault of the play. That's the fault of the player in this case. It's a good pass by Colombo. Again, it's a little bit of a low snap, but he's has his feet set. He delivers the ball fine here. Decent rush. A little bit high, but deflected. Not really the fault of Friend. It's just what happened. I thought the ball had hit. He had a better chance to catch it. He really didn't. He deflected it, which probably assisted in the interception.
So Brian, who's been the target of Villanova hostilities all afternoon, is able to come up with the interception. This is Gallagher, the fullback, out of the backfield, and he has himself a first down, I believe, as he gets to the Villanova 30. And I believe now that New Hampshire will burn one of those timeouts.
Okay, Wildcats, again, you know, now the defense has to come back on the field as they are now to do what they have to do, and that is, you know, recover from the turnover by the offense. And they can't afford to have what's, you know, to give up something now. They work too hard for the shutout here in the first half, and I'm sure that's what Coach Dan McNeil is explaining to Eller and Long at this point, that the Wildcats, you know, you've got to come up, step up and do the job right now, prevent the points.
They're in the third quarter up at Storrs. It is Tubby Raymond's Delaware team leading at Connecticut 28-10. 9.5 to go right now in the third quarter. A look at what we have coming up at halftime. That interview with the Reverend President will be with one Drew Gordon, and then Drew will rejoin me as we recap this first half, a half in which the Villanova special team set up a couple of touchdowns, another field goal, and it is 17-0, and the defense has starred against Bilbo's New Hampshire team and done pretty well. Now in his 20th season, 129-71-4. He is the Yankee Conference's all-time winningest coach. And right now he has his team, or he surveys and sees his team in a 17-0 hole. But 35 seconds to go in the second, and they still have two timeouts. Griffin over center at the 30-yard line of Villanova. And the pass eludes Barassa. Second down coming up, and the clock stops with 31 seconds to go.
Good rush by Timmy Mattis that time, Villanova's middle guard. He put the pressure on Griffin, did not allow him to set his feet to deliver an accurate pass, and that's why it's incomplete. He had Barassa up top open, and he just threw the ball in front of him too much, and although it stopped the clock, no yardage gained downfield. New Hampshire probably needs another 8 to 10 yards before they can legitimately attempt a field goal they would expect to make.
And they have the win right now to their backs. Second and 10 at the 30. Griffin cutting across, and the pass is complete to John Donnelly, the reserve tight end. Not much yardage, however. They do get inside the Villanova 30. Barry Alves with those two interceptions, also there in on the coverage. They spot the ball at the 29-yard line. So with 23 seconds to go, New Hampshire calls another timeout, and it will bring up a 3rd and 9. I'm surprised they're not running a few more out patterns and trying to get to the sidelines and stop the clock on their own. They've burned a couple of timeouts here in this latest series.
Well, I think with their timeouts, they probably didn't feel it was necessary that they had to go to the sideline, and you have less of a chance maybe of the completion because the sideline sometimes can act as a defender too. But again, the Wildcat defense playing, you know, very well, very tight, and this is a big play because, you know, right now New Hampshire has to look. If they don't make it here, they probably have to try a long field goal.
23 seconds to go here in the second. Villanova 17, New Hampshire nothing. Villanova scored on its opening drive after a terrific kickoff return by Jeff Johnson, then a good punt return by Oren Solomon set up another score. Griffin with a big third down. Under a rush, has some running room if he chooses, still looking. Now he fires for the end zone. It is caught. Touchdown, Barassa. Has the reception, so the turnover is costly as New Hampshire puts 6 on the board. We had talked ourselves, Drew, off the air about the big play, and it finally has arisen for New Hampshire as they put 6 up.
Well, it's a shame. You know, Villanova has the play cover. Brass, or Griffin in this case, he drops back. Good rush by Cobaugh at the top. Is not able to make the play, though. Good poise by Griffin. He's over on the sideline, and he just lets it go. Number 20, Brown, leaves go of his receiver, you know, because he thinks the play's not going to make it past the line of scrimmage or whatever. And Barassa shows why he's a real good football player. He stays in the play to the very end, sneaks to the back of the end zone, and gets open.
Point after from Lance Yelty is good. That is the 16th touchdown on the year for Barassa, his 4th touchdown reception. And the game now has a somewhat different complexion. Instead of throwing a shutout in the opening 30, the turnover cost Villanova. New Hampshire puts the touchdown up, and it's a touchdown and a field goal separating these two excellent Yankee Conference teams with 14 seconds to go. We'd like to make you aware of the 7th annual Andy Talley Villanova Football Camp, a week of non-contact football from Sunday through Thursday, June 21st to 25th. It's a day or overnight football camp for boys between the ages of 10 and 18 who are interested in improving their football skills. Villanova has selected some of their scholarship players from this camp. Coach Talley, his entire coaching staff, and some of the area's top high school football coaches providing instruction on all the basic football skills. The program adjusts to the campers' football experience, and special attention is given to the young boy who is just being introduced to organized football. For more information, 645-4105, 645-4105. Call early, get yourself a special 10% early registration discount. Well, I would imagine that New Hampshire is not going to risk any kind of return here and certainly try to knuckleball something.
Well, with 14 seconds to go, mm-hmm. There's no sense in doing anything that isn't going to be very, very conservative, and I think you're right. We're going to see New Hampshire just squib the ball down the field. Villanova will have time maybe for one or two plays. I think they're going to kneel down and go into the locker room with a 17-7 lead.
Here's Brian Cotler with what has to be a frozen left foot. And finally, Johnson is able to pick it up. And Johnson is brought down at about the 25-yard line. Time for one, maybe two plays. 7 seconds to go, 17-0. Villanova in front. Jeff Johnson, whose kickoff early on, whose kickoff return, I should say, set up the first Villanova score, which was eventually a pass to Pat Friend. That was a 5-yard scoring pass from Colombo. Then a Bill Hoffman 19-yard field goal, a Vernon Smith 10-yard run, and moments ago, Barry Barassa, the 29-yard haul-in of the Griffin pass. As Villanova this time is just going to let the clock expire. So this battle for first place is half complete. New Hampshire sitting atop the standings. Villanova with one loss, trying to pin a loss on their Wildcat counterparts. And right now at halftime, homecoming on the main line, it's Villanova by 10 over New Hampshire. Stay with us. Our halftime show will commence in just a moment on the Villanova Football Network. And right now, Harry Donahue is with the Villanova head coach, Andy Talley.
Thank you, Mark. And Andy, near perfect first half. Everything went your way up until that last series before halftime. What about the execution, the field position, special teams really set up that big advantage you had, 17-0?
Yeah, we're disappointed, Harry. We should have 4 or 5 touchdowns right now. I mean, to give them a cheap touchdown at the end of the first half just really hurts. I mean, this is an important game, and I'm really upset. I mean, we should have this game put away right now. And now we're going to have a fight in the second half because that's going to really pump them up. I'm very disappointed right now. We got to come back in the second half with some fire and put a couple scores in and play better. It's awful.
Thank you, Andy. Andy Talley headed to talk and shake things up maybe. A little disappointed that the Wildcats surrendered that touchdown in the final minute here before the end of the first half. Villanova, though, with the lead, 17-7. Let's go back to Mark.
Drew, I'm going to stay up here. I am not going to put my ear to the wall, the Villanova locker room at this point.
Well, I don't know how you feel, but after listening to that, I got a little bit, my heart started pounding a little bit faster, so I think the Villanova Wildcats are at halftime are going to hear, you know, Coach Talley's feelings very loudly.
Stay with us. Our halftime activities commence in a moment right here on the Villanova Football Network. Villanova Wildcat Football on Prism is brought to you by McGowan Lincoln Mercury Isuzu. Go west to McGowan. By Budweiser. Beechwood Age for that cool, clean, crisp taste. For all you do, this bud's for you. And by your Quality Plus Ford dealer.
Have you seen what's new for 92?
Have you?
Have you seen the big introductory savings on the all-new 92 Ford Taurus? It's all new up here and back here. More convenient and safe in here. Right now, save $1,200 on Taurus options and cash back, or choose low 7.9 financing.
Have you driven a Ford lately?
Now, get big savings on Taurus at your Quality Plus Ford dealer.
You might know who we are. We know who you are. Understand?
I want to see the truth come out and burn every one of them, and there's only one way to do that.
What is that?
Lie.
Time to tell the kids when my father came to America.
Well, can't wait till later.
You want to know? The kids should hear this story.
From now on, every nun for himself.
You'll never guess who's coming to dinner.
What?
Bodies of the recently dead are returning to life.
Tommy Gunn only fights in the ring.
Not my ring's out of sight.
Mark Zumoff back at Villanova here at halftime, and except for a Barry Barassa 29-yard touchdown reception late in that first half, the Villanova Wildcat defense would have thrown a shutout. It leads the conference in a number of defensive statistics. And here is more on what they're calling the mainline Marauders. The 1991 Villanova Wildcats can certainly put points on the scoreboard. But much of this year's team success has been the result of their stingy, hard-hitting defense. The mainline Marauders, or Monsters of the Main Line, as they have come to be known in these parts, have not only shut down their opponents with remarkable efficiency, they have punished them with an aggressive, swarming, gang-tackling style that has made them one of the best and most feared defenses in the nation. Ranked first in total offense in the Yankee Conference, this current squad is poised to be one of the best in the school's history. This week, we had a chance to talk with Villanova assistant coach and defensive coordinator Dan McNeil and some of his players to find their formula for success.
This is a group of players that have worked long and hard together for a lot of years, and this is a group of players that have very, very good chemistry. And when you put those factors together, you're going to have a good production, good consistent defensive performance week in and week out. And that's what we have. Our leading tackler is Curtis Eller. He has to be a standout performer, has been an all-East player last year in terms of coaches selection, and certainly will be one probably this year. Kevin Long, our senior strong safety, can just flat out play. He's a very good football player. It really has showed defensive tackle. Just put tremendous pressure on an offensive lineman. Andy Cobal, an outside linebacker, his rookie year. Athletic ability-wise, will put the fear of God into any offense that we'll go against. And a number of offensive coordinators have spoke to that effect. Danny Summers is anchored on the Rover, the tight end side. We ask a whole lot of him in terms of responsibility, and he has come through so very well for us. That's why we're a very good defense, because we have so many players who can stand out within the defense that play heroically, individual heroics, and do their job within. Amongst defenses that I've been on and have been around, this would probably compare as the best.
I think when we hit the field, it's a special kind of feeling when we're out there that makes everybody play above their potentials and their abilities.
We have great athletes on defense, and just the desire and the determination that we have every play, to get the ball and make the play, it's phenomenal.
I guess the main thing that you feel is excitement, We have a lot of different characters on the team, and everyone, their own personality helps push us along different ways. Different people have different types of personality. Like, some are very outspoken and others are very quiet, but we all put that together, and that helps us a lot.
Being the young guy on the defense, I tend to feel a little more pressure, because I got a bunch of seniors and juniors, older guys that, have been through it, and I feel this pressure that, I want to do well just for them.
Thursday night, Dave Brown has a touching reunion with some old teammates when the Flyers face off against the Edmonton Oilers. It's all the excitement of Flyers hockey live from the Spectrum. Thursday night at 7:30, only on Prism.
A new Ford Escort LX for $99.99. Which Escort LX? It's the price of the three-door, the new four-door sedan, the five-door, and even the wagon.
That's right, it's your choice. Four Escorts, one price. And all equipped with air conditioning, AM/FM stereo radio, power steering, rear defroster, power mirrors, and more. That's right, one price, $99.99, on the Escort LX at your Quality Plus Ford dealer.
Buying a new car can be a hazardous road to travel with lots of confusing signals. So where do you go for the best deal? Which way do you turn for friendly service? There's only one direction. Go west to McGowan. Great prices and friendly service. McGowan, Lincoln, Mercury, Isuzu in Westchester.
Yeah!
Go west to McGowan.
The Sixers swept Milwaukee in last season's playoffs, and Monday night the Bucks will be out for revenge. It's the nonstop action of 76ers basketball, Monday night at 7:30, right here on Prism.
Overcast and chilly on the main line. Homecoming at Villanova thus far. The Wildcats of Villanova leading the Wildcats of New Hampshire here at the half by 10. And on the sideline right now with Drew Gordon here during homecoming, Reverend Edmund J. Dahman, the Villanova University president since June of 1988. Drew?
My pleasure to be with Father Dahman, president of Villanova University. And Father, we're seeing a heck of a first half here today against New Hampshire for the Yankee Conference Championship, and kind of a culmination after 6 years of the success the Villanova football program's had.
I find it's incredible the way the program has come along so smoothly, so successfully. And you know, at the university, we've been talking a lot, focusing a lot on quality in all of our programs lately, like many businesses are. And this football program kind of epitomizes what we want for the university. It's at 1AA, it's an excellent program. We're playing good schools that we like to be identified with, and they're just performing in an excellent manner, and we're very pleased and we're proud of this team.
Well, you're doing it the right way too, and with the good scholar athlete.
Right, no doubt about that.
Okay. As president of the Yankee Conference, there's some new teams coming into the conference, and in 1993 there'll be a new alignment, because Villanova will be in the Mid-Atlantic, but you're adding the James Madisons in the Northeastern.
Yes, we've added three teams, William & Mary, James Madison, and Northeastern. And in order to accommodate that for our schedules, we have the two tiers, and Villanova will be in the southern tier, as you just indicated. The nice thing about the Yankee Conference is that the presidents really do direct the conference, and I'm no longer the president of the conference. We rotate that, and I was last year when we made this decision, and we think it's a good decision. The various levels, you know, the two tiers, will compete with one another, and there will eventually be a conference champion once the conference is fully developed.
And Villanova gets to continue to maintain their competitiveness, especially the rivalries with Delaware and William & Mary?
Absolutely. And we will be in the same tier with them, which is, and both of those are good teams, as we could see this year. One of them is a little too good this year.
Just that one day.
Right.
Okay, the development plans for Villanova, things that you mentioned earlier, you know, business things are difficult. I remember talking to 2 years ago down in Annapolis and Villanova played Navy. You were talking about the decade coming across the 90. Developmental plans for the Wildcat and for the Villanova University.
Yeah, things are moving along very nicely on schedule. As we indicated 2 years ago, we're celebrating the sesquicentennial of the university. Villanova was founded in 1842, and we've decided to celebrate the sesquicentennial in a full academic year, the academic year 92-93. And we've had a committee working on that now for over 2 years, and we have a whole series of events planned for the occasion, academic events, social events, cultural events, athletic events. And this will be an opportunity for us to simply celebrate Villanova and everything it stands for. And on that occasion, we will announce the public phase of a major capital campaign. We're just concluding the planning phase of that, and we're just about to begin what they call the silent phase of a capital campaign. So things are moving along. Even though the economy is tough, we're finding loyalty to Villanova, pockets of it all over the country, and we're cultivating that loyalty. And I'm confident that even with the difficult decade of the 90s, Villanova will be able to achieve its goals. And its goals are ambitious goals. But as I said, we are focusing on what we do best. And we realize that we have to raise endowment to offset our tuition-driven situation. And again, I think our alumni and our friends are well aware of that now. We're educating to that need. and I think they will join with us and accomplish it.
Okay, the best of luck, and it's on a national basis. You have to do that, and you want to still maintain the academic standards, of course, the university is so proud of.
Right, and we are recruiting students nationally at a level that we never did before. We have a full-time recruiter working in California, for example, and we're looking at Texas, Florida, Louisiana, the Midwest, and we're receiving a lot of more applications, and we will work on yielding those applications into good Villanova students in the future.
Very good, and let's hope that those good Villanova students play real well here in the second half in 1991. Thank you very much. We'll be back with more Villanova football after these messages.
Paul McCartney.
I'm not such a bad boy no more, no more, no more.
Quincy Jones. The men.
Tell me what to do.
The music.
All the lonely people, where do they all come from? All the lonely people, where do they all belong?
The movies. Give my regards to Broad Street. Listen up, the lives of Quincy Jones, Graffiti Bridge. The music comes alive this month on Prism.
You might know who we are. We know who you are. Understand?
I want to see the truth come out and burn every one of them, and there's only one way to do that.
What is that?
Lie.
I'm to tell the kids when my father came to America.
Well, can't wait till later.
You what? The kids should hear this story.
From now on, every nun for himself.
You'll never guess who's come to dinner.
What?
Bodies of the recently dead are returning to life.
Tommy Gunn only fights in the ring.
Get out of here. My ring's outside.
Well, it's not freezing, but it's in the low 40s, and we have quite a win here this afternoon. Villanova fans looking for a win. Their Wildcats lead it here at the half by a score of 17-7. Villanova actually scored the first 17 points of the first half. And Vernon Smith, who again is in there for the injured Pat Kennedy, doing a wonderful job at tailback there with the slight cutback and finding his way to pay dirt for the 10-yard run. That made it 17-0. Before that, after a nice kickoff return, Pat Friend caught a pass for a touchdown and William Hoffman added a field goal. And a few moments before halftime, a key turnover and Barry Barassa hauled in a 29-yard pass for New Hampshire to break the shutout. First down, rushing yardage again. New Hampshire averaging 190 yards per game just rushing. As you could see, a total of 120 yards or 112 yards of offense in that first half. Penalties hurting Villanova, but not to the point where they relinquished any points because of it. And the time of possession as Villanova got its rushing game going, was able to control the clock and a nice balance, 119 yards rushing and 129 yards of passing offense. So the late turnover enables New Hampshire to get the 7 points they needed, I guess, for some kind of psychological boost as they were being shut out. But right now it is 17-7 Villanova. Stay with us. We'll be back with a kickoff that starts the second half in a moment.
When I became president of the university 3 years ago, I realized that I had inherited the leadership role of a university that had been building momentum for more than a decade. And the momentum was a momentum toward academic excellence in so many different ways. Our programs were becoming first rate. Our faculty and students were becoming stronger each year. And the university at that point had reached a degree of name recognition nationally that it had never had in the past.
A new Ford Escort LX for $99.99. Which Escort LX? It's the price of the three-door, the new four-door sedan, the five-door, and even the wagon. That's right, it's your choice. Four Escorts, one price. And all equipped with air conditioning, AM-FM stereo radio, power steering, rear defroster, power mirrors, and more. That's right, one price, $99.99, on the Escort LX at your Quality Plus Ford dealer.
So we're enjoying our favorite spot, and we see this old guy.
Hey, Bubs!
Then there was this huge wave. We thought the old guy was history. That was hot. Anyway, we were impressed.
Guru Dude, want a cold bud?
Groovy!
Groovy!
Despite our language differences, all surfers share a universal communication.
Oops.
Whoa.
With Drew Gordon, I'm Mark Zumoff, getting set for the third quarter as Villanova will kick off to New Hampshire. And Drew, two impressive stats jumped out at me on the stat sheet. One was time of possession, a 7-minute advantage for Villanova. The other one was their balance in offense, almost identical figures rushing and passing. And another stat while we're at it is the fact that New Hampshire, their rushing total was really measly compared to the 190-yard per game average that they posted during the year. 24 yards rushing in that first half.
That's right, and only 85 passing, and a lot of them came on that last drive right before halftime on the interception that Villanova suffered right as they were trying to maybe run the clock out, try to steal some more points before halftime. But Villanova had almost 244 yards, I guess, in the first half, which is right at their average, right where they want to be. They have the 17 points. You know, the defense has played great. You know, they're in a good position right now. I'm sure it's as good as Coach Talley would have expected before the game.
Bill Hoffman, who had a field goal in that first half. Nathan Bryan. Again, they kick it away from Barasset, but Bryan isn't shaming himself as he finally stumbles up to about the 35-yard line. So New Hampshire, no doubt, would like to establish something here after that late touchdown. Let's go in the meantime downstairs to Harry Donahue.
All right, Mark, and I think the one thing that we could pick up at halftime from Andy Talley's comments is that he was really upset that Villanova is allowing New Hampshire to really get back into this game. They had him on the rope 17-0 a minute to go. They turned the ball over, then gave up the touchdown, and I think he realizes New Hampshire's just too good a team to let them get back into the game like Villanova did. Back upstairs.
Matt Griffin to the money man. Barasa gets a nice block from the reserve fullback and is able to turn the corner and get 5 yards. Lee McClinton, who is in there for Mike Gallagher. And meantime, we have a penalty flag on that play. Gallagher, who did well in the receiving department. Barry Alves, who has a couple of interceptions in this game, may be penalized here. We'll have to wait and see what the call is from referee Joel Goldman.
It's a face mask, and I was going to say, if that was a piling on call, that had to be a fast whistle as we had seen earlier. But no, it's a face mask, a 5-yarder inadvertent, and it'll give the first down to the New Hampshire Wildcats, but not the unnecessary roughness call, the unsportsmanlike contact that gives you 15.
Strong safety Kevin Long is the guilty party. Opening moments, third quarter. Villanova up 17-7, but New Hampshire very dangerous. Here in a first down. The give off of left tackle is taken by Kyle Cripps, as you saw Barry Barasa on the sidelines, and he won't stay there more than that one play. Cripps, the junior, 5'8", 180, is able to run it up just short of midfield, gain on the play of about 5 yards. Second and 5 coming up for New Hampshire as Barasa's back in there. McClinton stays in at the fullback. John Perry, who kept his streak going of 28 straight games with a reception, is number 11, but otherwise he's been rather quiet. Griffin keeps this one, runs for the first down and more as he is hit and dropped by the Villanova defense, but he gets the job done as he ran past the stick inside the 45-yard line. Kevin Long, perhaps trying to atone for his sin moments ago, put the hit there on Griffin.
This is one of those plays that comes out of a halftime scouting report. And then as everybody goes for Barrasso, they pull the guard, and there's nobody left to tackle the quarterback. Kevin Long does a super job that time, as you see him dodge the big offensive lineman. And just that's a picture-perfect tackle, just how they teach it in training camp.
Griffin, percentage-wise, and he, like Colombo, throws very few interceptions. But right there, he threw four. Last year, he threw four against Villanova. Putting it up this time, and it was overthrown, the pass intended for McClinton. McClinton, only a freshman, 5'10", 230, curling out of the backfield that time. It'll bring up a second and 10.
What New Hampshire got that time from the Villanova defense was the inside linebacker, Curtis Heller, trying to cover the back out of the backfield. And any quarterback will take that situation because you're just going to chase the play as Eller was chasing it. The ball just wasn't delivered on time. And again, the quarterback Griffin had to take a deep setup in the backfield rather than at 4 or 5 yards, and it forced him to throw the ball a little bit high.
So Griffin, whose completion percentage is going to take a beating, more or less committing himself to throw the ball here with a second and 10, and down he goes. Curtis Heller, the 1990 All-Yankee Conference teamer from his right inside linebacker spot, went untouched and down the throat of Griffin.
This is how you win big games. You make big plays, and you make the big plays are usually made by the big players. Heller doesn't just come in and force the play to go astray. He also makes the tackle. You know, if the quarterback gets outside that, you say, geez, what a good play, but he didn't make the tackle. Heller not only made the good play, made the tackle, forced the third and long situation. And that's how you win the big games. You make the big plays at opportune times.
Good field position play by the defense now as it brings up a third and 21. And Barrasso, the tailback, is out on a wing to the left. Crosses over, but this time they go down for Perry over the outstretched arm of Oren Solomon, who was back defending. Good coverage is also coming over, was the nickelback Chuck Murray to help out on the coverage of Perry. So John Perry, who's really had a good year for New Hampshire, has been shut down. The passing game in general has been closed off, and a fourth down situation coming up now. New Hampshire will punt it away. Eric Kutz will come in. Solomon, who had a nice punt return in the first half to give Villanova excellent field position. Kutz gets it away. A wobbler, it falls short. Solomon is snowed under immediately, and Villanova will set up shop first and 10 on their own 23-yard line. Their first possession of the second half coming up in just a few moments. 12:29 to go. They lead it by 10 on this, the Villanova Football Network.
Villanova is a religious-affiliated co-educational university with an important educational, spiritual, and philosophical mission. From a student body of just 13 in 1843, Villanova has grown to nearly 12,000, with about 6,400 full-time undergraduate students. Students come from every state in the nation.
Hollywood Movies, Home Team Sports, a combination you can only find on Prism. It's movies like Hamlet, Reversal of Fortune, The Rookie, The Neverending Story Part 2, and The Sheltering Sky. It's the best sports lineup in Prism history, with every Flyers home game and more Sixers games than any channel on cable or broadcast TV. It's more than a movie channel. It's more than a sports channel. It's Prism this fall. Don't miss any of the action. It's the only channel you need for the best entertainment on cable TV.
Well, you got to hope that blanket has a cord running to some outlet somewhere. It's cold. It's not frigid, but it's cold. And that wind continues right now to blow actually diagonally, but for all intent and purposes right now into the face of Villanova here in the third quarter.
Okay, the Wildcats again, you know, the first possession here in the second half. Let's see if they didn't catch a little bit of Coach Talley's unsatisfaction at the end of the first half at halftime.
Single setback as Jeff Johnson right into the heart of the New Hampshire defense that time. Jeff Oliva, Steve Dunn, Oliva, the All-America candidate, and a definite pro prospect along with Dwayne Saab, as mentioned. A handful of scouts here. Buffalo Bills are being represented, New York Giants, Los Angeles Raiders, in fact, even the Toronto Argonauts. Second and 7 for Villanova. They're at their own 28. Colombo on the delay to Johnson this time, and Johnson is dragged down by one of those pro prospects, the senior Dwayne Saab.
And Johnson, a good workhorse for the Wildcats. He played a great first half, and he did it not only from his fullback position, Jeff did, but he also did a nice job on the kickoff returns. He blocks well. He's been running the ball well this afternoon, really coming to the dance, you know, with everything prepared when Kennedy wasn't able to play today.
Villanova performing very well in third down conversions, coming out conservatively here, and Colombo's going to put it up on third down. Pass is caught, the first catch of the day by George Brown, his ninth reception of the year, but it is incomplete, and that brings up a fourth down. So the Wildcats came out very conservatively. They ran twice into the line to Johnson. The little swing pass to Brown does not connect, and now they have to give it up.
Hey, Brown actually should have caught that pass right now, and it's easy to say from up here, and it's cold out there, but you have to make those catches on the third and two, third and three situations. It's a high percentage pass play. Just go down to the ground, catch the ball, and take your first down.
Second punt of the day for Bill Hoffman, and it is not a good one. A wobbler. And good field position coming up for New Hampshire at their own 43-yard line.
25 yards on the punt, that's not going to be not real good, but it does give New Hampshire, with a strong wind to their back, good field position here to start, you know, their second possession of the second half.
The Villanova Wildcats close out the 1991 regular season home schedule with the University of Massachusetts. That'll be next Saturday, November 16th at 1:30. No better way to experience just how exciting this year's Villanova team is than to see it in person. Good seats available. Tickets 645-4100. That's 645-4100. 4 minutes gone, third quarter. Villanova 17, New Hampshire 7. It is Barassa on the pitch, and he gets substantial yardage close to midfield. Nice chunk on the running play for New Hampshire on the first down. Mike Jones in there to trip up Barry Barassa.
Barassa, this is what he likes to do best, take the ball deep. He has the lead back, kick out for him and cut back inside, and he likes to run north to south there. That's good first down play, pick up six, almost 7 yards on it. Easy play to execute, very low risk, and sets up a nice second and three, second and four situation.
Nice block by the right guard, Mark Schneibel, on that play, and it's second and four now. Griffin again to Barassa, cuts back this time, and is able to scissors his way inside of Villanova territory. Tim Madison, Mike Jones brought him down beyond the first down stick, and indeed it will be a first down for New Hampshire.
Here we go again, same play, except it's a handoff this time. He comes up to take the handoff, but he knows where he wants to go, and that's to the outside. Gets the good kick out block, and then turns it up inside and picks up, after making some people miss, picks up 5-6 yards on the play.
That was Schneibel again, pulling right in front of Barassa. First and 10 now in the Villanova 46, and Griffin, a little bit confused, elects to call a timeout. 9 minutes and 52 seconds to go in the third quarter. New Hampshire will discuss how to cut into this 10-point disadvantage.
Paul McCartney. I'm not such a bad boy no more, no more, no more. Quincy Jones. Prince. The men.
Girl, tell me what to do.
The music.
All the lonely people, where do they all come from? All the lonely people, where do they all belong?
The movies. Give my regards to Broad Street. Listen up, the lives of Quincy Jones, Graffiti Bridge. The music comes alive this month on Prism.
New Hampshire with a first and 10 on their, well, on the Villanova 48-yard line here, as they've just come up with a first down. Matt Griffin calling a timeout. Barry Barassa has been able to get on track at least a little bit more here in the second half, but not nearly the yards he's used to chewing up against opponents. Griffin, the play action, has some room, and it is incomplete. Pass intended for Mike Gallagher, who was one of his more consistent receivers in the first half, the fullback, and it'll bring up a second and 10.
It's a coverage sack that time, or not a coverage sack, but just great coverage in the defensive line, forced the quarterback Griffin to go to the outside. He, as much time as he had, and it seemed like he had 7-8 seconds that time, he still couldn't find anybody open and had to throw the ball out of bounds and take the incompletion. Great coverage by the Wildcats. You know, that's how they scored at the end of the first half, by that kind of scrambling, buying time, and the defenders came off the receivers before the play ended. That time the Wildcat defense stayed right with everybody.
Now Barassa is flanked to the right side in a slot. Gallagher, the lone setback on 2nd and 10. Griffin has the room, and just that quickly, the room is closed off. Chris Krakowski is able to make the tackle on Griffin. It'll go as a rushing attempt for Griffin, not a sack, and it'll bring up a 3rd and 10.
That's a nice play by Grahowski. He'll just come off his block there, almost being double-teamed, comes to the inside. Look at the athletic ability, just coming, cutting back to the inside as the quarterback tries to go out of there and making the tackle.
And almost everyone on this stunning defense will be back next year. Only a couple of seniors, Willie Oshedon and Kevin Long, the strong safety. Griffin, on what looked to be a quarterback draw, does not have enough for the first down. He does get to the Villanova 40 before Barry Alves is able to pull him down. It'll bring up a 4th down now, and it looks as though we have a flag, and it's going to be against New Hampshire.
The holding call against New Hampshire, and that's a big play for the Wildcats, a good break for them, because it's going to take New Hampshire out of position. Predetermined play. Boy, good blocking up there up front. Barry Alves does a nice job. He lowers the boom when the quarterback prevents the first down. And now it's tough because Villanova has to make the decision whether to force 4th down or give them 3rd and 10 before New Hampshire has to determine whether they want to gamble and go for a 1st down inside Villanova's territory.
Harry Donahue is on the sidelines now. Harry?
Mark, I get the feeling that things have kind of settled down a little bit in this game, and it may be because, at least from Villanova's standpoint, that the Wildcats are very careful. They don't want to make too many mistakes, similar to what happened there at the end of the first half. The defense is doing its job, though. New Hampshire still has not been able to get on track, but I think things have kind of settled in a little bit here after that first half, and I think the Wildcats may be playing a little close to the vest against the Wildcats from New Hampshire. Let's go back to Mark.
3rd and 24. No time to be conservative here. New Hampshire's got to put it up. Griffin, Oshedon has him in the backfield. Willie Oshedon with the sack on Matt Griffin.
It's just great defense because they're not blitzing or stunning. They're just coming right at him. Oshedon, he's just doing the outside rush that time. He just blew by the offensive tackle for New Hampshire there and made the tackle in the backfield. That's just a big leg play there by Willie Oshedon.
4th and 31, I would punt. And Eric Kutz is in to do the honors. Solomon is deep. Alves about 10 or 15 yards in front of him. Good spiral. Solomon is cornered, works his way up, and is able to salvage some yards. Still on his feet at the 40, 45 at midfield. What a run by Oren Solomon as he comes back almost from the dead to move it into New Hampshire territory. And the punter, Kutz, who's got some good size at 6 feet 215, runs him down. But Oren Solomon has his second very nice return of the afternoon.
Watch Oren Solomon here. You talk about not giving up on a play. He'll come to the right. He doesn't have a whole lot of room here. And now it looks even worse as there's 3 white jerseys, but he somehow comes out of it, and it's like, get out of my way, here I come. The whistle hasn't blown yet. Good blocking on Villanova, and it's a shame they didn't get that one last blocker. Maybe Solomon could have taken it all the way.
Well, the Villanova offense opening it up now. Pass down the sidelines. It is incomplete. Pass was intended for West Philadelphia High Scott Thompson, and it was incomplete.
You know, I think if you see that on a replay, you're going to see the ball hit Scotty Thompson right in the middle of the shoulder pads. I just don't think he has the leg speed because of the injury to his foot to run under it, or at least the confidence to believe he does. Watch this ball come down. He touches the football. He could have caught that. I just don't think he feels comfortable with his feet that he has the good base to make the play.
Thompson, the second leading receiver this season, playing sporadically because of a stress fracture. It'll bring up a 2nd and 10. Villanova at the New Hampshire 46. Johnson the delay, good blocking, quickly closed up, however, very nicely. Dwayne Gordon at his right end position was able to close it off. Harry Donahue now back on the sidelines. Harry?
Well, on that last play before the last rushing play, there was the incompletion that Colombo put up. And after the pass got off, he got run into by Dwayne Saab. And Saab, of course, goes about 6'4". They list him in the program. He's, I think, a little bit bigger than that. And Tommy Colombo was a little upset, said something to the official about the late hit. He didn't get the flag, instead the incompletion, and also the late hit.
Third and eight with 7:07 to go in the third quarter. Villanova nursing a 10-point advantage. Bad snap, but Colombo, like a shortstop, able to pick it up on the short hop. Got it out to Johnson as flags fly. Preliminary indication is a face mask against New Hampshire. That would be a tough break for them here on the third down play.
That is a tough break because, again, bad snap, but Colombo's able to pick it up. And this is not a first down play. New Hampshire plays it well, and Johnson doesn't have any chance, quite honestly, there. Inadvertent face mask, but he didn't leave go very early, and the flags came flying. That's going to give Villanova a big first down inside New Hampshire territory, and again, keep this drive alive.
Dwayne Gordon is the guilty party, as he had his hand on the cage of one Jeff Johnson, who now comes out of the game. It'll be a first down and 10 for Villanova now on the 34 of New Hampshire, 6:46 to play here in the third quarter. Mike Vedero in as a flanker now. In motion is Strawn Lumpkin in the I formation for Vernon Smith. Smith gets around one man, gets some yardage down to about the 30-yard line. Good play by Vernon Smith, as penetrating very quickly was Jeff Oliva into the backfield, and he was able to escape his grasp and make some money.
Another flag on the play. Again, they come in spurts, it seems, holding against the Wildcats. So we see Smith again. Just his speed on this play is going to pick up 1 or 2 yards. Unfortunately, it's all going to come back. But he and Colombo miscommunicated somehow in the backfield that time. That's not exactly the way that play was supposed to be run, and yet Vernon was still able to make something out of it.
On the offense, we're going to repeat first down.
Referee Joel Goldman making the official call here before the assembled at Villanova Stadium homecoming. 6:13 to play in the third quarter, and they march it off now, and it goes back to the 43-yard line. So it'll be a first and 20 coming up for Tom Colombo.
Actually, that's about an 8-yard penalty, which means that the holding call had to be called across the line of scrimmage, since now they mark off from the point at which the infraction occurred.
Well, he can't see anything, but at least he's warm. First and 19 is what they're calling it, as Colombo will throw on first down. Pass is incomplete. Pass was intended for Kevin Mosley, who ran for 110 yards last week against Rhode Island. He has seen sporadic action here, as Jeff Johnson has gotten the bulk of the action at the fullback spot.
Number 87, Dwayne Gordon again. He comes across the line of scrimmage, and he reads Colombo's eyes. He sees him look to the right. He just tries to get in his view and then get the big arms up. When you're 6'2", you can do that against a 5'6" quarterback.
Second and long for Villanova, as Mike Vedero is back in, and Vernon Smith is out on a wing out of the tailback spot. Colombo passes complete to Vedero, all for about 3 yards, as he is brought down just inside the New Hampshire 40 around the 39-yard line. Chris McGrath, the all-time leading tackler for this New Hampshire team, was in on the stop.
Villanova had what they call a stack on that play. That is two receivers lined up behind each other, and the intent of it is to be able to run a screen like 4 or 5 yards downfield. They got the pass completed, but they didn't anticipate the tackle to come that quickly.
Is that the same as a pick play? Oh, that's illegal. I shouldn't say that. Third and 14. Just over 5 to play in the third. Colombo has the time. Going deep for Friend. He can't come up with it. Nathan Bryan at the last second, who has been victimized a number of times here today, that time would not succumb. And Friend, who has a touchdown catch already to his credit, unable to come up with that one. It'll bring up a fourth down, and Bill Hoffman will come in for Villanova.
This kid has a big leg arm. He throws this down here, and again, it's perfectly thrown, but good coverage by New Hampshire. Friend appears open. And boy, what a great play by New Hampshire, too, as they came and converged on the ball. Nathan Bryan, who the Wildcats have picked on an awful lot, this, especially in the first half, and was successfully picked on. Friend caught the first touchdown pass over him, made a real nice play there as he came in on the football, and just as Friend reached back over his outside shoulder to catch it, he put his hand up and knocked the ball away.
Well, here you go. Scott Thompson hobbled with a stress fracture. Harold Hart spent the week in the hospital with a staph infection. He is now gone for the afternoon. They're the number two and three leading receivers for Villanova. And now Pat Friend is still laying in the end zone being attended to by the Villanova training staff.
Well, it looked appeared that he was holding his knee there, his left knee or right knee, as he went down. And it looks like that you can't tell from there. His left knee, as trainer Dan Unger holding Pat's friend, hand there right now, and they're checking as the doctor's checking for how his knee joint feels.
We'd like to make you aware of the 7th annual Andy Talley Villanova Football Camp, 1 week of non-contact football from Sunday to Thursday, June 21st to 25th, a day or overnight football camp for boys between the ages of 10 and 18 who are interested in improving their football skills. Villanova has selected some of their scholarship players from this camp. Coach Talley, his entire coaching staff, and some of the area's top high school football coaches providing instruction on all the basic football skills. The program adjusts to the campers' football experience and special attention given to the young boy who is just being introduced to organized football. 10% early registration discount. Call the Villanova Football Office, 645-4105, 645-4105. Well, the good news is Pat Friend is up, but the bad news is he has to be helped off.
He's not looking real happy right there, but at least he's bending his knee and not walking as if he can't put any weight on it. And hopefully it's just a sprain or a bruise that he banged on the AstroTurf, and that in a couple of minutes that'll go away and he'll back in there. That's a big loss, you know, with the Wildcats having lost Hart, and they didn't have Scotty Thompson now. But, you know, Pat Friend's the next big guy to go to throwing the football.
Hart, we are told, is gone for the afternoon as they fake the punt, and it is kept. And they have a first down and more. He's going to go all the way for a touchdown. Pat Smith, what a play! With 4:57 to go in the third quarter, Pat Smith on the fake punt, a touchdown for Villanova.
What a great, great call. What a well-executed play. And all the credit there has to go to a coaching staff and a bunch of players that play together and pay attention. Watch this, ladies and gentlemen. Two snap from centers, but guess who? What? That's what I thought was happening too, but the second snap didn't occur. Great play by Smith there. Everybody checking to make sure he's there, and he just catches everybody by surprise. You know, on the other side of the field, Coach Bowles has to be saying, hey, you guys deserve that one. That's about as good of execution as you can get.
We're talking Globetrotter material on that play. Wow.
Hey, you know, that's play of the week stuff. You know, on some of your the highlight shows, that's got to be a play of the week. What execution, though, and you have to give credit to everybody, but Pat Smith, what a super job there, and the whole Wildcat specialty team there on the punt just does a super job, and what a gutsy call. Even Talley's smiling right now as he's walking up the sidelines.
Hoffman's point after is no good, but could it possibly take away from that fake punt run for a touchdown by Pat Smith? So the score now is Villanova 23 and New Hampshire 7 with 4:57 again remaining here in the third period. Well, I didn't even suspect in the least, and clearly New Hampshire had no idea.
Well, when you saw the short snap, the immediate thought was great play, great time to call a fake punt, and good call by the coaches there. But the way that play went, nobody could have anticipated that. You know, in all the years of watching football and playing it, you know, you've seen some things where people line up away from the ball and so forth. Never see a play like that again.
Harry Donahue is now on the sidelines. Harry, what'd you think?
Well, I'm here with the current athletic director, former Villanova quarterback, Ted Aceto. Nothing like a little gimmick play there to get you 6 points.
I'll tell you what, they put this play in 2 days ago, and it was hiked to one of the blocking backs, and he snapped it like a center, but he held it. Everybody went after long, and he took off around the left side, and we scored a touchdown. So it worked well.
Good day for Villanova here. Big game, and it's also a homecoming.
Well, I'll tell you what, we got a great crowd here, and we're looking forward to if we beat, you know, New Hampshire today, that with the two games remaining, we can get a bid to this NCAA tournament. So we're looking real good today. And I think we're going to score more. It's fourth quarter coming up, too. So we're happy about it.
An optimistic Dr. Ted Aceto, Villanova's AD, former Villanova quarterback. Mark, back to you.
23-7. And Drew, you know, when you see a play like that, you think that some assistant coach must have woken up in a cold sweat at 3 o'clock in the morning and called Andy Talley and said, Andy, I got this play. We got to talk about it.
Well, the guy that celebrated and jumped around most was offensive line coach Mark Ferranti. Now, you know, and I'm just saying he's a very emotional guy to begin with and does such a super job with the linemen as we've seen today displayed. But he was jumping up and down almost. I had the thought, that was mine. That was my play all the way.
Hoffman to kick off. Let's see how New Hampshire reacts after being burned on the fake punt. Barassa. Dan Summers made the tackle there as Barassa works his way up close to the 30-yard line, and New Hampshire will take over after an 8-play, 46-yard drive that consumed 2:56, capped by the most unconventional fake punt you may ever see.
Donovan's drive again, 2 minutes and 55 seconds. They go 46 yards in 8 plays, but again, that's a highlight type play. You're going to see that one many times this week on a lot of TV shows, and again, something that those with the Wildcats will never forget.
Griffin with first and 10 on the 28. Directing reserve fullback Lee McClinton in front of Barassa. They go straight ahead with Barassa, who gets good yardage across the 32 around the 34. Chris Gronkowski, who's been very busy this afternoon, makes the stop for Villanova.
If New Hampshire's going to make a move, you know, with a legitimate amount of time left, now's the time. They've been burned. They're going to react. You know, they're champions. They're a good football team. They're going to react in an aggressive way right now. But this is a critical drive for them, and just as critical, obviously, for the Villanova defense if they can stop this time that New Hampshire has the ball and force a punt.
It's been a tough afternoon for Matt Griffin, who has been throwing well below his season completion rate of 54%. He's already thrown 4 interceptions. There's something about the Villanova defense last year. The Wildcats intercepted him 4 times. That was up at Durham, Durham, New Hampshire. 4 minutes even to go in the third. Griffin keeps it himself this time as he thought he saw some daylight there around that right corner. He is about 2 or 3 yards short of the first down.
Willie Ocean, the offside defensive end for the Wildcats, or tackle, he chases the play down from the right side as New Hampshire, again, anticipating a Villanova in a man-to-man defense, or they check off of the line of scrimmage. Option play is a good play to call because nobody covers the quarterback. And Griffin tried to tuck that in, but Willie Ocean, in demonstrating his speed, comes down the line of scrimmage and made the play.
Big play for New Hampshire. 3rd and 2. And they go to Barassa, and he goes nowhere. Barassa is ripped down as Chris Gronkowski went right for the ankles, and Barassa did not have a prayer. In fact, he even lost a yard. Big defensive play by Chris Gronkowski in Villanova.
Penetration on the left side of the screen. Give the ball to Barassa in the backfield. Gronkowski right off the block. What an athlete. You need to play off the block like that and still keep your head up and your feet under you, and then be able to reach out and make a tackle against a pretty good running back.
Eric Kutz. Good high spiral. Kutz has gotten off some nice ones today, and Solomon in turn has returned a couple of beauties. Right here, however, he's finally surrounded and dropped right at his own 30-yard line. And that is where Villanova will take over. Leading this game 23-7, Sean Curry was down on the coverage against Oren Solomon.
Harry Donahue had indicated earlier, Mark, that maybe Villanova played a little bit close to the vest, and I think we're going to see that same type of offense here on this drive. You know, they're playing into a wind. There's no sense of taking any gambles. You don't want to get too overly protective because, you know, the game's certainly not put away by any means, but you don't want to take any unnecessary chances.
Tom Colombo with the backs in the eye. Johnson is leaning Vernon Smith. Smith the call. Sees no hole, so he tries the left end, and nice pursuit there to take him down. Good play by Dwayne Gordon, who had to catch Smith from behind.
Don't forget, too, Villanova's lost their wide receivers for the most part. I mean, the top 3 of them anyway. So they have to be a little bit more conservative in their approach. Again, maybe you expect to see the double tight ends, but maybe a pass to Donald either on 2nd or 3rd down here.
Coming out of the game is Mike Vadero, and Scott Thompson, who's got a bad wheel, is in there now. He is split out of your screen towards the bottom of the right-hand side of the line. Villanova, it appears to be a double tight end, and they go straight ahead to Johnson. Well, this is Iron City football here as they go with the double tight ends and Johnson, the Aliquippa, Pennsylvania native. Steve Dunn, Chris McGrath combining to stop Johnson as he plows ahead for a few yards. It'll bring up a third down.
Jeff's not looking particularly happy on that play as he goes back to the huddle. He didn't have any place to go on that one and expected a little bit more room. Pat Friend, a sprained knee, may return to the game, and hopefully that's all it was, just a bad bruise or a slight sprain where he's able to come back in there.
1:25 to go out of the eye, a third and five for Villanova. Colombo will go up top. To the sideline he goes, and it is overthrown. The pass was intended for Mike Vidaro. Let's go to Harry Donahue, who now has an update on our friend Pat Friend.
Pat Friend is, of course, nursing an injured left knee, and he is sitting right here behind me on the Villanova bench, Mark. He just told me that basically it's a sprained knee. He's got ice on it right now. He landed hard on it in the end zone on that incompleted pass. He says there is a chance that once they take the ice off, if it feels all right, he could come back in the fourth quarter. We'll have to wait and see.
Of course, with this cold, it is tough to really get that sprained knee loose as Hoffman kicks that one to Nathan Bryan, and Bryan is able to get it up to the 38. Chuck Murray was down on the coverage. And New Hampshire has an opportunity here with 1:09 to go in the third quarter. They have to get cracking. They trail it 23-7.
Boy, Hoffman does a real nice job that time. You know, you're kicking into a wind like he is, and it's swirling, and you know, you can make a mistake there, but he drives the ball down the field. He doesn't worry about the spiral and all the form. He just gets a good strong leg and tries to keep the ball low, and he gets the good coverage from his specialty teams, and not a good return by New Hampshire.
Griffin on first down with the backs in the eye. He throws, almost intercepted. Mike Jones had a hand on it, couldn't come up with it. That's all Griffin needs. He has four INTs already in this game.
I'll tell you what, Villanova's defense is playing about as good and smothering an offense as you can do it. Here's Jones. He honors the fake, and now watch him get back into the play. Number 36, right in the middle of the screen. Just eyes the quarterback. I don't really know what Griffin saw there, where he saw an opening that he could complete it, but Jones felt he should have had the interception. Good play. Good play by Mike Jones. And again, Villanova's defense has just smothered this offense that's very potent for the Wildcats at New Hampshire.
Griffin, 9 for 25, 88 yards. And penalty flags fly here on second down.
It's going to have a delay of the game here, and they didn't get the play off in the 25 seconds allotted. That's an aggravating type of mistake when sometimes it is caused by the play maybe not coming in on time or whatever, but you know, you can't line up incorrectly before, you can't have a penalty before the snap's called unless you're really, you know, really a mental mistake.
So now a second and 15 for New Hampshire with 1:02 to go on the third quarter clock. Griffin hasn't had a day like this all year, nothing close to it. He only had 8 interceptions coming in. Second and long, Griffin, and it is incomplete. David Gamble was trying for his first catch of the day. Both the wide receivers, Perry and Gamble, have really been quiet here, indicative of the fact that Griffin has not thrown for a very high percentage at all.
No, he hasn't, and again, that one should be caught. It's thrown properly enough, but the ground kind of causes that incompletion, as it's Villanova's Wildcat defense that are there, but the pass is thrown to the inside. Should have been caught for, you know, it would have been a big first down for New Hampshire, but they're going to have to still have their third and 15.
Villanova at one time was 50% in third down conversions. Still 6 for 15 is not too bad. And a timeout is called by New Hampshire. So they only have one timeout remaining now, as they burned one earlier in the third quarter, and now they burn the second of three. So not good for them, already trailing by 16, to have just one timeout remaining. And Griffin now goes over to the sideline to confer with Bill Bowes and his coaching staff.
We're talking right now. One of the things that you have to really be conscious of when you're talking to your quarterback like that, and he's had the kind of afternoon he's had to put up with, is not to lose confidence in himself. He's still a good football player, and you have to make sure that he still believes that in himself and that he still can execute the plays. And sometimes when the balls get dropped on you, you know, and you get the hard rush and so forth, you start to lose a little bit of confidence in yourself, and they got to make sure that he keeps that stiff upper lip and keeps hanging in there, because they're not out of the game yet. They have more than a quarter to go, and they only trail 23-7.
Delaware 49, Connecticut 18, up at UConn. So Delaware with a win now will stay with one loss, and should Villanova win this game, the top three teams in the conference will have one loss. They'll all be 5-1.
Villanova's opponent next week, and again, somebody you have to contend with, assuming they can stay with this game. We'll talk about that in a second.
Griffin on third down, intercepted by Solomon, the fifth interception of the day. Solomon into New Hampshire territory. He is driven out of bounds by an aggravated David Gamble, but Solomon comes up with the reception, and Villanova gets themselves another turnover.
Mr. Griffin's getting he's completed as many almost to the Wildcats as he has to his own receivers. But he's rifling the ball like as if he has somebody wide open, and he really doesn't. I mean, Solomon's right in position there to make the play. What a great afternoon this guy's having. Arn Solomon, number 6 for the Wildcats. Punt returns, the interceptions, nice open field tackles. He's made several of them. Great effort.
And it looks as though they're tacking on a penalty. Perhaps a personal foul there on that tackle of frustration by David Gamble. So now New Hampshire has Villanova very deep in their territory at the 16-yard line. And indeed, there is reason to sing here at Villanova with the Cats already leading by 16. First and 10 for Tom Colombo. And now they can afford to keep it on the ground and do what they please with Vernon Smith, who tries to get it around end. Nice pursuit, however, on the play by Bob Jordan to keep that gain to a minimum.
We were talking about earlier, Mark, was the fact that Villanova has to play Massachusetts next week, and they're a good football team. You know, they won that Yankee Conference last year with a very stingy defense and a pretty decent offense, and they're leading today 42-14 over Richmond up at Massachusetts, and although they don't have the real fine record, 42-14 a final, Massachusetts had won, so, you know, that's going to be a tough opponent for the Wildcats next week.
A final at the Vet, Boston College 33, Temple 13. Second and 8. Colombo to the end zone. He's got a man, that's Thompson, and it is broken up at the last second. I don't believe had Scotty come up with that, it would have been a touchdown, as he and Nathan Bryan, I think, came closer to the ambulance there in the left corner of the end zone than the end zone itself. Actually, that was Pat Friend. So it's good to see now that Pat Friend, number 19, not number 15, Scott Thompson, is back in the game after that sprained knee.
That's a tough play, a square out and up right there. I mean, the defense was there. Decently thrown pass, but tough to throw that all the way across the field when you only have 16 yards to deal with, 26 with the end zone. But boy, you usually on that type of play, you need more playing field.
Friend now out of the game on a 3rd and 8. New Hampshire showing blitz. Now the backers back off. It's Smith with Johnson leading the way. Cannot turn the corner. He has run out of bounds. It'll bring up a 4th down. And I believe the field goal unit will be coming onto the field now for the Wildcats.
Villanova runs the option. They've run it several times this year, and I kind of get a kick out of it because Tommy Colombo does not really want to run the football, so he's going to pitch, and yet it's pretty much an automatic when he comes down the line of scrimmage like that. And yet sometimes, although not successful there, they found it to be a successful play this year for them.
Bill Hoffman made one from 19, missed one from 40, had another blocked. This will be a 31-yarder out of the hold of Tom Colombo. It's certainly long enough, and indeed it is good. So Bill Hoffman goes 2 for 4. He comes off limping. And now is being helped off by a couple of teammates.
He must have pulled a hamstring or something on the kick. That was a heck of a kick. He drove that very hard. He would have made that good from another 20 yards out. Nice 26-7 lead, 19 points, but he must have pulled either a groin or hamstring muscle on that kick.
That was into the wind. And now with 20 seconds to go, Villanova makes its lead 26-7. Well, I'll tell you, it doesn't get any better in terms of the injury situation for Villanova, as now their kicker goes hobbling off, and he will not be able to do the honors on the ensuing kickoff.
Unless it's something that happened to him where he got hit and knocked, where he's just hurt a bruise type of thing that stuns you, but it goes away in a couple of minutes. Hoffman 4 field goal attempts this afternoon. He made the first one at 19 yards, and he missed 2, one from 40 and one from 31. And now he's made a 31-yarder, so he's at least at 50%, but 6 important points for the Wildcats.
Well, as the Villanova training staff attends to Bill Hoffman, Pat Burling will come in, a sophomore, 5'11", 174, out of Marple Newtown in Newtown Square, Pennsylvania. We'll kick off here. And one thing Villanova has done very well today is keep it out of the hands of Bourassa.
They haven't, even when he has returned to kickoff, we haven't seen that great 40-yard average, because I think the key to this is the Wildcat defenders coming down, making sure they fill the lanes. One thing that New Hampshire makes you do as a kickoff team is you better play the whole field, sideline to sideline. They don't set up that wedge where they put everybody together and go up the hash mark or up the middle of the field. They do a great job of making you spread out all over, and they give a guy like Brassa with his speed a lane to run in. And that's why I think you see the fake handoffs and the reverses back there, is again, it makes everybody stay on the defense, spread out across the field.
So Burling wisely keeps it low. Ball is kicked around. Finally, it's recovered by McClinton, the backup fullback. And he falls on it in his own territory, and New Hampshire will take over with 12 seconds to go on the clock. So not only does New Hampshire here stare at a deficit of 19 points, but in the fourth quarter, they go against the wind.
That's right, and again, that's a mental mistake on the kickoff. You have Brassa, the leading kickoff returner in the country, standing behind you. Why do you try to pick up the ball when it's being squibbed down the field like that? Just let it roll to him. And as an attempt to try to kick it, pick the ball up, you kick it across the field, and now you have no chance at all for a return.
Matt Griffin, whose afternoon thus far has been one he'd like to forget, goes for Perry behind a Barassa block, caught from behind by Barry Alves, but he works his way up to about the 30-yard line, and that should just about do it for the third quarter. The clock to our left expires, and indeed, that is it for the third quarter of play here at Villanova. So the Wildcats put 9 unanswered points on the board. They lead it by 19. We'll be back on the Villanova Football Network. Villanova Wildcat football on Prism is brought to you by McGowan Lincoln Mercury Isuzu. Go west to McGowan. By Budweiser. Beechwood Age for that cool, clean, crisp taste. For all you do, this Bud's for you. And by your Quality Plus Ford dealer.
So I'm doing my sound check.
Oh, hello, hello.
And I hear this woman's voice.
Crunch that last chord. I'll show you.
She grabbed the guitar. And then she started rocking. No, I mean rocking.
You're pretty good.
Not. Someone that hot deserves something this cold. Suddenly, I remember this was a Bud spot.
I like your style.
Founded in 1842 by the Roman Catholic Order of St. Augustine, Villanova today is situated on more than 200 acres of wooded countryside in the heart of one of America's most scenic and historic areas. The original campus was a country estate connected to nearby Philadelphia by the main line of the Penn Central Railroad. Today, the campus retains much of its original charm.
Have you seen what's new for 92? Have you seen the big introductory savings on the all-new 92 Ford full-size truck? It's been reshaped up here and around here with all new comfort in here. Right now, save $2,100 on F-150 options and cash back, or choose low 7.9 financing.
Have you driven a Ford lately?
Big savings on F-150 at your Quality Plus Ford dealer now.
Moments ago, Villanova kicker Bill Hoffman was helped off. Harry Donahue has an update. Harry?
All right, Mark, I just talked to Bill. He said on that 31-yard field goal that he made right after the kick, one of the New Hampshire players came in and actually got him right on the outside of the left knee. He's a little ginger on it right now. He's walking around on the sidelines. Villanova counts on him not only for place kicking, but also for punting. And he told the special teams coach he thinks he'll be able to do both. We'll have to wait and see. Back up to you, Mark.
The left knee, the planting knee of place kicker Bill Hoffman.
To be vulnerable if somebody hit the outside of it, you have it planted down there. And Hoffman's a young guy, and a lot of responsibility has been put on him this year. You know, to kick off and punt, you know, it's a little bit unusual to have to handle both responsibilities. And for a young guy, a rookie, he's handled them pretty well this year. And although it's, you know, he struggles a little bit sometimes with the field goals, he's done a great job for the Wildcats.
Third and two for Matt Griffin in New Hampshire now. They need a lot of territory to be made up, and quite a catch and quite a tackle on David Gamble, as Gamble made the reception. He paid for it, but he was able to get it out to midfield. Barry Alves delivered the hit on Gamble.
Griffin drops back, good protection, and he throws it quickly. Now, you know, maybe they expected a shorter pass, but boy, found the zone open that time, wide open, and Alves playing it good, playing it very well, though, makes a tackle, but not after the catch. Gamble's first reception this afternoon, but kind of a big one, gets him out to midfield.
Yep, very important completion for New Hampshire. First and 10 right from the midfield stripe. Opening moments, fourth quarter. Griffin, with a blocker in front of him, gets about 5 yards as Willie Oshedon, from his right tackle spot, came all the way over to the other side of the field and chased him down.
Okay, third quarter, the Wildcats, again, had got a little bit closer, but Villanova still dominating, especially on offense, with 313 total yards with the 14 first downs. Penalties have hurt him a little bit. The turnover is the big thing there. That and time of possession, I think, is pretty illustrative of why the score is the Wildcats 26 and New Hampshire 7.
And again, it bears repeating, New Hampshire averaging almost 200 yards a game rushing, and don't expect too many more yards rushing. They have to put it in the air, down 19 points, 26-7. Griffin on second and 5, and that one may have been tipped by a Villanova lineman, Chris Krakowski. We've said his name a number of times today, haven't we?
He's been all over the field. He's has several sacks for the Wildcats this year. Three, four, or five. He leads up there with Eller and Oshedon, and he does a nice job that time of knocking it down. Fortunately for the Villanova Wildcats, the receiver was wide open there. Somebody, probably an inside linebacker, normally have that back coming out of there, did not pick him up, and it's a good chance, good thing that Krakowski did make the play.
Barassa now out in a slot to the right with Gamble. Gallagher back to block, now curls out of the backfield, and that play doesn't work, as it's an incomplete pass, bringing up a fourth down, and New Hampshire will have to give up the football as Andy Cobol is into the New Hampshire backfield. 13-14 to go here in the fourth quarter. Villanova by 19 on this, the Villanova Football Network. And New Hampshire now will give it up the punter, Eric Kutz, whose right leg is at a workout today, although he has kicked very well.
Villanova doesn't believe they're going to punt it.
Not at all. As Oren Solomon comes up to play right corner, he's not going back. And Kutz would like nothing better than to just have this baby drop into the corner, and that's exactly what he does. Kutz does it perfectly. And if there's any moral victory for New Hampshire to gain out of that, it's the fact that they have Villanova backed up as far as they've been all day, back to about their own 1.5 yard line, where they'll take over first and 10.
Finally, the ball bounced right, at least for New Hampshire that time, as the ball rolls out of bounds on the 2 yard line. Wildcats in a difficult position right now. They have to be very careful. They don't have the turnover down here this deep in their own territory, but Villanova not sending anybody back because they really, I think, believe that New Hampshire's going to go for it, paid a little bit for that.
Well, it looks as though Villanova is going double tight with the one wide receiver and the backs out in the eye. Colombo, first and 10 from his own 2. Smith. And they can breathe a little bit now as Dwayne Sabb came up and was able to tackle Smith. He got about 2, maybe 3 yards on the play as he worked his way out to about the 4 yard line.
Smith's done a great job for the Wildcats here, filling in for Pat Kennedy here this afternoon. He carried the ball very well. He caught the ball when he had to. He's done a real credible job, a real fine job in a big game, filling in for a guy that's not easy to fill in for, Pat Kennedy.
Now Kennedy with an elbow chip and a torn tendon, but there is a chance should Villanova, or a ligament I should say, but there's a chance if Villanova makes the playoffs that he'll be able to return. Smith, good yardage, has the first down. That's a big play for Villanova and a backbreaker for New Hampshire, who had hoped here to squeeze Villanova down deep in their own territory and force a punt. But the offensive line and Vernon Smith thought otherwise.
Watch, that's a trap here by 61 Kramer. Well, look at watch the surge at the end of the play, not only by Smith. Watch the offensive linemen come here and push everybody. See them all, they're just pushing it forward, and that's the reason Villanova has the first down. Good hustle, good downfield pursuit by the Wildcat offensive line, making sure that they finish the playoff.
Your boy Mark Ferranti there without a jacket. But I guess he's so excitable, he generates enough heat that he doesn't need one. Andy Talley, of course, is enrobed in his official Villanova football outdoor garb.
Coach Talley looks like he may have even calmed down a little bit. He's still very intense, though. And at this point, sometimes when you're trying to protect a lead as he is, you're a little bit more intense and you worry a little bit more about things than if you're sometimes trying to come back.
Vernon Smith now at the century mark, 23 carries and even 100 on the day. And we still have 12 minutes and some change to go here in the fourth. Play action, Colombo coming out of the backfield. Actually, that's the tight end, Scott Donald, and he makes the reception, and he gets about 3 yards on the play. I thought for a second it was number 28, but it was number 82. Is that dyslexia? Is that what they call that?
Whatever it is, it was a great catch.
Scott
Donald coming again on a little bit of delay to the outside, to the lower part of the screen. Colombo fakes the draw to Johnson. That holds the linebackers in, and this is what allows the tight end to get out to the outside with nobody there. Fine catch here. Almost was horizontal to the field as he made the catch.
Gain of 3 on the play as time marches on. 11:20 here in the fourth quarter. Villanova nursing a 26-7 advantage. Big yardage for Johnson as the big fullback plows for another Villanova first down. No flags on the play as Steve Dunn made the tackle, but too late. So the Wildcats squeezing out of a tight situation here, now able to breathe a little bit easier as they get the ball out to their own 26 and another first down.
One of the things that makes great football teams is when you have to do something, you're able to do it. When you have to ground it out, you know, dig deep and run the football, you're able to do it. Villanova's demonstrated that this year. When you have to throw the ball, can you throw the big play, the short pass? They've done it. They've been able to do it all, and right now we're seeing again that they have to ground it out right now, and they're able to do it.
And they're doing it with the twin tights in the I formation, and Smith following Johnson. Off left tackle across the 30 to about the 33-yard line. Dwayne Gordon and Chris McGrath there, riding Vernon Smith up to the 33-yard line. A gain on the play of 7.
If Dwayne Sabb, number 95, is 6'4", I'm 6'2". Because I'm watching him as he stands up next to the Villanova linemen who are blocking him, and those guys go about 6 foot, you know, 6'1", and he towers over them.
For those who have never seen you, Drew, I will say that you are indeed not 6'2".
Man.
Second and 3. Smith again. Good running room, first down and more as he's driven out of bounds at the 45-yard line. Vernon Smith, 100-plus yards now as Bob Jordan put the hit on him. But Villanova keeping it on the ground as they should. Mike Pacenti, the left tackle, leading the way for Smith. And as you say, they keep it on the ground, doing what they have to do. An even 10 now for New Hampshire as this gray day begins to look darker for them.
Okay, again, the toss to Smith in the backfield. Craig Johnson leading up through the hole. He takes care of the linebacker. You get a broken tackle by Vernon Smith, and then some more yardage up the sideline. You know, Pacenti makes a good block on the corner. Just great execution, good hard, basic football.
Iron City football. Smith again, and it's 5, 6, 7 yards a pop, and New Hampshire is helpless here as the offensive line is just driving them back.
I'll tell you what, the offensive linemen right now are having a ball. Because they don't love anything more than drive blocking, coming off the ball. You know, pass blocking, maybe the techniques aren't as difficult sometimes, but boy, you're backing up, retreating, and people are coming at you and banging you in the head and pushing you aside and so forth. Now they get a chance to go after people, and believe me, they love this.
Makes Colombo's job a heck of a lot easier. Just turns and hands it and says, go ahead, Vern. It's all yours. Gain on the play of 6, 2nd and 4. That time it wasn't so easy as he and Johnson collided. But Jeff Johnson takes lemons and makes it lemonade as he's down to around the 46. It is just short of the first down. Ron Basden in on the tackle for New Hampshire.
The timing's off on this play. Colombo turns a little bit too much. He probably should have just gotten out of the way. I mean, you know, stepped aside. He reversed out. And his big fullback Johnson runs into him. But boy, when things are going well for you, still pick up 2 and 3 yards because of the extra effort. And because things are just going well for you, and you take it, you take what they give you.
Double tight end. Smith, another first down. Barely, but I believe he has it. Squeezing inside the New Hampshire 45 that time as he went around the right side. And the clock continues to go with 8:30 to go, and New Hampshire down to only one timeout, and Villanova is playing ball control. Keep in mind, they started out at their own 2, and now they're down to the New Hampshire 45.
Vernon Smith that time too showed great maturity as he went to the, as he took it off tackle, cut in. Now, a lot of times, you know, he before would have cut that to the outside, tried to get the sideline because of his speed, and maybe given up the first down, okay? But this time he cuts back to the inside, not a whole lot of room. But assuming he gets the first down here on this measurement, that was the smarter play to make in that situation.
Harry Donahue on the sideline as they measure for the first down. Harry?
Well, what they're doing here, Mark and Drew, at least from this vantage point, Villanova's just lining up with seven guys across double tight end formation, and they're really popping off the ball and getting Mr. Sab and company on the other side of the ball a little upset. Especially watch Clements, who is an all-versatile lineman here. He's actually lined up as the left end, 58, for the Wildcats. He's a center, but he's been really in Sab's face this whole series. He's not in there right now. He just came off after that first down.
8:15 is Colombo behind Tim Tarpeyan at center. Vernon Smith again. And more than five this time, closer to seven or eight, as the Wildcats are just, well, it looks almost just like a blocking drill out there. Andy Mott, first time we've heard from him today, a freshman was in on the tackle.
He lines up 9 yards deep in the backfield, and to do that you have to have a jet start, and that's exactly what he has right, you know, that he's demonstrating here coming out from the 2 yard line. Smith over 125 yards on the ground along with Jeff Johnson in the backfield. He has over 60 yards on the ground, so the Wildcats really churning it out almost over 200 yards rushing here this afternoon.
Don Ferraro in at fullback, giving Jeff Johnson a breather. He takes that handoff. Very close to another Villanova first down. Of course, Villanova didn't want to throw the football. They didn't have to. I'm not even sure they have any healthy wide receivers remaining to throw the football. But they're doing, as you say, what they have to do. And the fans here enjoying it. I think they're enjoying it from the standpoint that all these running plays chews up the clock and shortens the game now somewhat.
Well, they did it against Connecticut earlier in the year when Connecticut gave them a challenge and at least took the lead on them, when Villanova had to really assert themselves in the second half and just show them that they were a better basic football team. They did it.
Third and about half a yard. And New Hampshire reticent to give that up.
Wildcats over 5 minutes now that they've kept the ball away from New Hampshire since they took it over. Although it looks like the time of possession just went over. It looks like a fumble here.
Fumble, and it's recovered by New Hampshire. Well, the fans don't seem to notice, or perhaps they think it's already in the bag, but Andy Mott was able to recover the fumble here for New Hampshire.
Here's Ferraro taking the ball. Looked like the handoff was clean enough. He just didn't have it tucked away hard enough. You know, you've got to protect that a lot stronger than that when you're running up in the middle of the line. It wasn't a big hit, but enough to jar the football loose.
Eric Kutz was able to pop that ball free from Ferraro, the sophomore fullback who was spelling Jeff Johnson. And now Griffin and company will take over. Three wide receivers as Griffin has to put it up in a hurry. Barassa out of the backfield, across the 42, about the 42-yard line. Curtis Eller covering on the play.
Eller shows great speed on this play. The screen again develops nicely. They get the people out in front of Brasso to block for him, and Eller gets around his blocker behind everybody and still has the speed to make the tackle on a fast back.
Well, New Hampshire needs three touchdowns here, down 19 points. Griffin for Barassa again, almost intercepted. It could have been Cobol and perhaps even Kevin Long. That would have been what, the sixth on the day for Griffin?
Sixth on the day. It would have been a great catch if he's able to make that. He showed his athletic ability there by being able to leap up there. Good protection for the quarterback, and he throws a good pass out there. Almost a great interception, but again, the Wildcats, good under coverage. That's a tough pass for a quarterback to have to complete when you have to throw the ball all the way across the field, over three linebackers' heads, and then get the ball down to the receiver again.
Cobol, only a freshman. And he's had an excellent year for Villanova. 6:40 to go on a third and four. Griffin with the time this time, unfortunately, threw to the wrong side of Mike Gallagher. And a fourth down coming up for New Hampshire.
I'm surprised to see New Hampshire putting their punting team on the field right now if you're going to try to win the game. And tough mm-hmm. to do right now, but you've got to keep the ball. You can't give it back.
And maybe there's a pipeline to our booth here, as it looks as though their offense is coming back on.
Well, there's personal foul, a dead ball foul, some altercation after the play. I didn't see a fight, so it's either a shove or some bad language used or whatever, but unfortunately for the Villanova Wildcats, it's going to go against them and allow New Hampshire to keep possession of the football.
For those of you who are tuning in a bit early for Never on Sunday, scheduled to go at 4:30, be advised that we have 6:35 to play here at Villanova, and you will see Never on Sunday tonight, Saturday night, as soon as this game is over. It is 26-7, Andy Talley's Villanova Wildcats in front. A victory will tie them with New Hampshire and Delaware for first place in the Yankee Conference. In the playoff system, 16 teams are selected in 1AA. The Yankee Conference gets an automatic bid and probably a wild card team. How do you break the logjam with those three players? I'll ask Drew Gordon in a few moments as Barassa gets the call and gets about four. What do you do if there's a three-way tie at the end of the year?
Well, you have tri-champions, but you have the three champions, and that's how they've done it in the past. I mean, for playoffs and for other things, they'll go to, you know, it scores points for and against and that type of thing. But, you know, one of the things through the Yankee Conference in the last several years is I think there's only been one year where there's been one team that's actually won the championship outright, and that there wasn't a sharing of it between co-champions, as there are most of the time. It's been two and three teams sharing the championship.
Willie Oshedon, who's always around the football, Andy Cobaugh is too. And it was Cobaugh who was able to tip that pass. So a third and six coming up now for Matt Griffin. Ball is on the Villanova 39-yard line as this Wildcat defense has been extremely stingy. Only a turnover late in the first half cost Villanova as Griffin hit Barassa with a 29-yard touchdown pass over the middle, and it is incomplete. Pass intended for John Donnelly, the tight end, but Mike Brown put a crunch on him to make sure Donnelly could not come up with a football. Chuck Murray was also in on the coverage. It brings up fourth down.
Nice to play defense when you can just sit back and allow everybody to play in front of you, and you don't have to play it tight, and that's what Kevin Long does here, and then just times it to come up to the receiver and, you know, really put the hit on him, and in this case, he was able to knock the ball loose.
Fourth down in New Hampshire, has to go for it here. Fourth and sixth. Trips formation, Barassa out of the backfield, Gallagher the fullback now in motion. And Griffin goes his way and he's got the first down. Squeezes inside the Villanova 30-yard line. Mike Gallagher, who's probably been the most consistent pass catcher today, Oren Solomon covering.
Another play for that keeps New Hampshire's drive alive and their scan hopes alive too, as they're able to complete the ball out in the sideline. But Oren Solomon, boy, what a great job he has done this afternoon. He's been all over the football field, you know, making big plays and great open field tackles.
Fumble by Griffin on the sack. Villanova has recovered. Alvis on the sack. Chris Gronkowski recovers the football.
Well, the defense has smothered the offense for New Hampshire all afternoon here, and that's just a closing, hopefully maybe for the Wildcats, we're going over a closing play for them as they, again, smothered the quarterback, Griffin. The Grahowski forces the fumble, forces the ball to be coughed up, and then the Wildcats recover.
A good look at a good player who's performed well today, Chris Gronkowski. With 5:37 to play now, Villanova will do more of what they've done a good part of this fourth quarter. They'll sit on the football with a double tight end formation, the one wide receiver. That's Mosley into the game now. Kevin Mosley, who despite running for over 100 yards last week against Rhode Island, has been used sparingly here today. Of course, it's no great shame with Jeff Johnson, the fullback, playing well, and Vernon Smith. Barry Alvis, not a bad day. Two interceptions, a sack, forced a fumble. Knocked away a couple of passes. 10,416 here on homecoming. And the tailgate parties will have that much more in the way of revelry, as Villanova most assuredly will win this one. Kevin Mosley again the call with under 5 minutes to go now. Villanova cruising at 26-7. Chris Neal on the stop for New Hampshire.
Again, the Wildcats just grinding it out here, and good to see Kevin Mosley in the game. But boy, you have to give credit a lot this afternoon to the Villanova Wildcats offensive front line with Pisani and Crane and Tarpey and Maracek and Lacey and Clements and Downs filling in when it was necessary for them to do so. Really did a great job of controlling the line of scrimmage for the Wildcats, allowing them to run and throw the ball effectively.
Mosley again, this time. Not much running room around the right side. Some finals for you. Delaware 49, Connecticut 18. That was at Storrs, Connecticut. So a win today and three teams, New Hampshire, Villanova, and Delaware, will all be tied atop the Yankee Conference at 5-1. Boston University 27, Maine nothing. Massachusetts 42, Richmond 14. UMass will be here next week, and plenty of tickets are available for that one. Local scores, Boston College 33, Temple 13, Princeton 17, Pennsylvania 12 is on fourth down. Bill Hoffman, after being injured, that left knee was injured earlier, but he's able to punt it away, and New Hampshire will take over. Harry Donahue on the sidelines. Harry, you all right down there?
All right, Mark, trying to keep warm here. I think two things really stick out in the second half that it really turned this game around as far as Villanova is concerned. It was the fake punt that ran in for a touchdown. And then here in the fourth quarter, when the Wildcats had themselves pinned inside their own 5-yard line, they put together a sustained drive, ate up about 6.5 minutes, 7 minutes of clock. And as Drew just mentioned, you really have to take your hats off to the offensive line. They have done an outstanding job this afternoon. Mark?
Matt Griffin, and he is snowed under by Willie Oshonen. And that's the kind of afternoon it's been for Matt Griffin in microcosm. And with less than 4 minutes to play, New Hampshire will go without a huddle, trailing 26-7. Second down, and Perry, who we mentioned earlier, has that consecutive games streak going now at 28 straight, in which he's caught at least one pass. But that offensive line has performed extremely well. John Maracek, the right guard, Tim Tarpey, the center, as we give credit where credit is due. Let me ask you honestly, was the offensive line expected to perform as well this year as it has performed?
Well, I think so. They knew they have good players up there. They were all experienced players. I think the coaching staff realized they maybe didn't have the greatest amount of depth that you'd like to have, but certainly good football players. Here's another interception. Curtis Eller, the captain of the Villanova defense,
running it up the sideline to the 10, and he gets to about the 5-yard line.
Yeah, the offensive line's done a great job, as well as the defense, which we can talk about in a second, but nice job here again. Here's the replay on that. Griffin drops back, and defensively, you just watch the quarterback now when you're a linebacker. Poorly thrown pass again, you know, this time by Griffin, and boy, the interception's mount for him. And Eller knows what to do after he catches it, though. And you look at the athletic ability and the size, he shakes off a tackle there, turns up the sideline, and we got hit hard at the end, but great, great return. Kind of an indication, too, of how this afternoon has gone. The interceptions, big thing, you know, New Hampshire was not known for turning the ball over coming into the game, and yet the Wildcats have forced New Hampshire to turn the ball over 6-7 times.
Third interception of the year for Curtis Eller. First and goal from the 5, and before Tom Colombo can take a snap, a timeout is called.
Eller a little tired here on the sidelines, but boy, he's happy.
You know, the thing about this team, and again, on the defense, they'll lose a couple of seniors. The offensive line, there are a lot of juniors. You say they have experience, yet they have another year coming back. And you have a team here that is certainly probably going to earn itself a share, if not a Yankee Conference title outright. And the vast majority of the players are going to be back next year.
That's right. You know, and they're strong at the skill positions, too. I mean, they're going to lose Pat Kennedy, but they have their receivers back again, with the exception of Scotty Thompson. They have the big tight ends back, Nanny and Donald. Colombo's back again. You know, all those guys have good backups, too. Villanova has always used 3 or 4 receivers per game. That's how they shuttle in the plays to the quarterback. So they have a lot of exposure, a lot of experience. And, you know, you watch today, and you see a guy like Kevin Mosley backing up a Vernon Smith, who was backing up a Pat Kennedy. And you have depth at that position, too. Pat Smith does a great job at fullback. He backs up Johnson, the big fullback. So, you know, a lot of good people there. We mentioned earlier about the Yankee Conference and the champions, and since 1985, only 1 year has somebody out and out won the championship, and that's the University of Massachusetts last year. Before that, Maine, Villanova, and Connecticut had shared it in 89, and in 88, Delaware and Massachusetts. So it's something that's been shared by many teams throughout the years.
First and 5, Colombo on the bootleg, the naked one at that. And he throws, and it is caught in the end zone. I believe it's Scott Donald.
Scott Donald, nice. He just stood back there at the back of the end zone.
And it's a touchdown for Villanova.
Nobody covered him. He was open from the beginning of the play, from when as soon as the ball was snapped, he snuck out there. Nobody covered him. It just took Tommy Colombo, because Donald was not the primary receiver, a little bit extra time to find him. You're going to see Colombo bootleg here. He does this so well, and he's looking to the right now. He's not looking behind the end zone, and he'll look back to the inside right there and sees him, and the little guy can still throw it even when he's running away from the receiver. That caps it off there. And that's a nice touchdown. Good to, again, a turnover by the Villanova defense sets up the opportunity for the offense, kind of the way the whole game is going here this afternoon.
Hoffman hits the upright, and it goes through. I'm going to take Bill Hoffman with me to Atlantic City, I think. 3:15 to go in the fourth. It'll be a Villanova win. Let's go downstairs now to Harry Donahue.
Well, we're just 3 minutes away, as you mentioned, Mark, from the end of this thing. At halftime, we talked to Andy Talley and how he was so upset because the Wildcats had given up that late first-half touchdown to allow New Hampshire to kind of creep back into this ball game. What has happened here in the second half, however, is Villanova has never allowed New Hampshire to really get going. And we talked earlier, Drew did in the pregame, about the importance today of Colombo and Scott Donald hooking up, and that's exactly what has happened so far today, especially here with that touchdown there, and how Villanova once again being opportunistic and taking the advantage of another opportunity through a turnover. And they've had a bunch of them today. Mark?
Turnovers and special teams, and Villanova turnovers leading to 17 points. Turnovers in which they were able to force through one fashion or another. And on the year, Colombo now has thrown 17 touchdown passes, and 8 of them have been to Scott Donald. 9 of them have been to Scott Donald.
I wonder who his favorite receiver is when he's down near the end zone. Yeah, another thing that had been questionable, maybe, or not a whole lot, but something that hadn't been really demonstrated yet in the two tough games Villanova's played, that being Delaware and New Hampshire today, was Villanova's defense. You know, they were able or demonstrated the ability to stop Delaware's offense in the second half, especially when the offense kind of mounted a comeback. Colombo got real hot throwing the ball. And, boy, they certainly answered that question this afternoon here, as the Wildcats have just totally taken everything away that New Hampshire was good at. They kept Barassa away from returning kickoffs. They didn't allow him to go crazy on him. They controlled him. They contained him very well. They didn't allow Griffin, who completed 58% of his passes last year, 54% this year, to get going with a whole lot of things either. And then, of course, the turnovers, I mean, the interceptions, the fumble recoveries and so forth, and making the big plays when they had to. You couldn't have a more dominating defense here than the Wildcats of Villanova demonstrated this afternoon. And that's good coaching, too. You know, that doesn't come by accident. And Coach McNeil, the Villanova's defensive coordinator, indicated that, boy, there was a lot of instruction necessary this week because of all the formations that New Hampshire throws at you. They really had to make the kids think.
Griffin still throwing. Catching that time was John Perry. And the reception counts, and it gets New Hampshire very quickly up to their own 43-yard line with 3:03 to go in this game. In case you're just joining us, Delaware has already won convincingly at Connecticut, 49-18. And the Villanova win forges the three-way tie atop the Yankee Conference. Perry on first down. With 2:52 to play and the clock is running. New Hampshire, by the way, with only one timeout remaining, but again, that's all academic. Matt Griffin on second and one. Throwing for Perry, who's wide open, and he couldn't get it to him. And I'll tell you, in a somewhat humorous note, it looked as though the football landed right inside that punter's net. That's like an amazing something or other.
I wonder if they're going to give
that's got to count for something.
Well, you wonder if they'll give the right ball back to them now, too. But Griffin, he just heaves it over to the sideline and not there, right into
score.
The net. Right into the net.
Anytime I see a net bulge, I have to yell score. Third and short, about a yard for Matt Griffin to Gallagher, who's been his favorite target today. And Gallagher into Villanova territory. And time continues to tick away, and a large portion of the homecoming crowd has either left or gone to the tailgates or perhaps seeking shelter. The lights have been on for the entire second half here. It's been overcast all day. It's been windy. And the wind never really came into play as we thought it might in terms of the kicking game, since the game never boiled down to the kickers themselves. Over the middle, Gamble can't come up with it. Villanova almost comes up with it. Devian Logan was down there. Chuck Murray was a nickelback. And that'll bring up a second down with 2:19 to go in the game.
With the score of Villanova 33, New Hampshire 7 kind of dominating, you would think that Villanova or the winning team with on top would have had some long scoring drives. And statistic that we have here, Villanova's longest scoring drive, only 46 yards this afternoon, which is, you know, again, that strategy played early to get the good field position, and then the offense or the defense creating the turnovers for the offense. They didn't really have to drive all the way down the field today to get their points.
Griffin quickly, and Villanova players are still in there hitting. Chuck Murray delivered a tattoo job that time to Barry Barassa.
Here's Griffin again dropping back. He gets pretty good protection, quick over to Bavasso, and Murray, who just loves to hit people. I mean, he loves that free safety position. That's a great
fumble.
Job.
Alvis in a wrestling match with a New Hampshire player, and Villanova has it.
A little extracurricular activity going on down there, which is not atypical of when you have two good football teams playing against each other, and one's leading 33-7 with less than 2 minutes to go.
Well, no Pat Kennedy, but Vernon Smith has stepped in his place, and he is standing right now with Harry Donahue. Harry?
Mark, Vernon Smith has jumped in. 28 carries today, 135 yards. Vernon, did you think he'd get the ball that often today?
No, I really didn't think I would get the ball that much. I thought they would spread it out amongst the running backs, but since they did, you know, have enough heart in me, confidence, and giving me the ball, I had to do the best I could.
Coach Talley said this would probably be the biggest game that he's had since he came to Villanova. I know the pressure kind of on you guys to perform when he says something like that, but I thought the Cats did a great job right away. You established the tempo of the game, and that was set up by the opening kickoff return and then that first series.
Right. We had to do that. We had to knock them out the box early. New Hampshire's a good team, and if you don't take care of them early, they'll come back and it'll haunt you later on in the game.
And you've done a great job subbing for Pat Kennedy.
I'm trying to do the best I can, you know, under the circumstances, you know.
Well, it was good enough today. Big win. Vernon Smith with 135 yards, 28 carries. Another reason why Villanova today just totally outclassed New Hampshire.
Drew Gordon, I'm inclined to think that the special teams really set the tone here today. We could say what we want about the offensive line, and certainly credit deserved all around, but the tone was set by the special teams.
Well, you know, it's interesting that you said, because down in Delaware, they said the tone was set, you know, by a couple of bad plays in the beginning of the game, and all of a sudden it falls apart on you. Well, a couple of good plays were made by the special teams early today, and that set the tone, too, as the Wildcats just got off running and then never looked back. 9 turnovers by New Hampshire today.
Ooh.
I mean, that's incredible.
Ooh.
And for a team that doesn't turn the ball over that much, they had a +4 ratio coming into the game this afternoon, and they're -5 now, and nobody, I don't think, could have predicted that one.
1:25, clock running. Villanova on a 1st and 15, they fumble it. And I think New Hampshire has it.
Hopefully it's just 2nd down. Villanova's had 4 turnovers too, which haven't hurt them here this afternoon, but again, that's a little bit unusual for them. They don't turn the ball over normally that much.
Well, Villanova retains possession, and the clock continues to run, and we have a minute to play. This has been a long game. We are here now over 3 hours, 3 hours and 15 minutes to be exact. Our kickoff today at 1:30. They kick it off next week against Massachusetts. Plenty of tickets are available for that one. The Yankee Conference closer for the now first place Villanova Wildcats. Well, they have a third of the pie anyway.
And Villanova with the 4 turnovers, they have a +5 today. That gives them a +12 for the year. That's good football in anybody's league. And incorrectly, I said earlier that New Hampshire, they'll have a -1 with the 9 turnovers, you know, the 5 difference today. And again, normally teams with a real good record, 7-2, don't have usually have a very pretty good plus number on that turnover ratio, and that's a key indication of how you control the football.
In case you are wondering, Villanova has put a bid in with the NCAA to host a 1AA playoff game. 16 teams again are taken. The Yankee Conference with an automatic bid and probably a wild card team. as Mosley gets the call here on the second and long. That bid is actually a number of tickets. And should you outbid someone else, you get the game. 22 seconds remaining, and that should be it. As Tom Colombo leads the Villanova players in a handshake with New Hampshire, and indeed, en masse, the players come out to greet one another as the final 10 seconds of homecoming click down. So Villanova, there was some wondering among some of them, some of their fans, some of their following, could they win the big one? They had lost by 10 at Delaware. But they took on nationally ranked New Hampshire today and put all the doubters in their place. The final score, Villanova 33, New Hampshire 17. A big win, as Andy Talley said, the biggest game of his career here at Villanova thus far.
When they did it with total domination, and you can't ask for more than that. Big game next week. They have to win it against Massachusetts, and then hopefully it's on to the 1AA playoffs for them.
Ken Sellinger, our producer, Robert J. Ayers, our director. For Harry Donahue, who patrolled the sidelines very nicely today, thank you, Harry. And for Drew Gordon, I'm Mark Zumoff. Stay with us. The movie that was due at 4:30, Never on Sunday, coming up here on Prism. I'm Mark Zumoff saying goodbye from Villanova Stadium.